You are now entering the world of Musings of a Geek Podcast Network. Stay geeky, my friends.
This is a Danger Entertainment Podcast. DangerEntertainment.net. Danger Entertainment Podcast Network.
Hey there, kids. Do you want to hear a show where a bunch of guys sit around in a comic book store and talk about comics and lifestyle choices, other goofy things and shenanigans they get up to?
Have we ever talked about comics? Usually it's people sitting on my lap and riding the struggle bus.
That's true. It's mostly shenanigans. but occasionally we talk about comics. And if you like any of those things, comics, shenanigans, Devin's lap, then you need to check out Snake Oil Comics with me, Travis, and my beautiful co-host, Big Dev.
Find us on iTunes, Stitcher, and snakeoilcomics.com.
Broke Suki, Superman before Zack Snyder ruined him.
Man,
Michael Keaton was the best Batman, while Christian Bale was just deadpan. No one remembers the other ones. Princess Leia in bikinis,
ooh, yeah,
and Transformer Lamborghinis.
Hell yeah.
Please don't let Shia LaBeouf ever act again.
Please, God, no.
Remembering tales from the crypt, back when Michael Bay wrote good scripts.
He wrote good
all
scripts.
All right here is old mystery. It's the history of bad.
It's bad.
It's the history of bad.
So bad.
It's the history of bad ideas. It's the history of bad.
It's bad.
It's the history of bad.
So bad.
It's the history of bad ideas.
Podcast.
Welcome to the History of Bad Ideas, episode number 96. I'm Jason.
I'm Jeff.
I'm that other guy.
Blake.
That one guy.
Mark Rubio?
No, you know, that one guy.
Jeb?
That one guy.
The crazy homeless guy who sits there
and
yells?
That one guy? Yeah.
Oh, welcome.
That one guy.
Oh, welcome.
I can be any one guy.
You can't. You're a master of ceremonies.
Can you be two guys?
I'm an everyman.
He's like the chameleon Spider-Man. Right?
Chameleon Spider-Man?
Yeah. Isn't that him? The guy that can change face? Yeah, that's
I've never heard of the chameleon Spider-Man.
Oh, not chameleon. Shut up. Anyways, welcome, everybody. Thanks
I'm
for
like
listening.
The magic man. Now you see me? No, you don't.
You're David Blaine?
No, he's Cal
Cal Jr.
Cal Motton Jr.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
The Magic Man.
The Magic Man.
I have no idea. Anyways, is that similar to the Soul Man?
No.
Anyway.
Anyways, thanks, everybody.
Remind us to keep our jokes to WWE
sphere
reference, Jeff.
Then I might be in trouble because I won't get them.
Or He-Man.
I did buy the WWE 2K16 game. Love it. As my wife tells me, it's Project Runway for men because I've had it for over a week and I've done 8 matches. And
otherwise, you're just giving designing
I'm getting
people outfits
because of all the semi-nude guys that are on there.
There's
game.
A lot of semi-nude guys. No, I'm creating my universe because I'm the GM and the owner of them. So I'm starting my own shows each night. I'm doing tag teams. I'm building tag teams.
Can you create your own character and walk around the ring with a big bat?
Oh yeah, you can do anything. Yeah.
Or a big speakerphone.
Like a bat, like a animal bat, or like a baseball
vampire
bat.
Baseball bat.
Okay, vampire bat would be better.
Or you can walk around with your own pet monkey on a chain or
ooh,
something.
You could call him Maurice.
Yeah.
He could be a space cowboy. Anyways, hopefully this week no technical issues. We apologize.
Man, hold on a second.
We think we got it right.
He puts in a Steve Miller reference.
He did.
But he doesn't get our Cal Naughton Jr. reference.
No, he doesn't.
That's impressive.
Thank you. Of how my wife calls me the smartest, or what is it, the dumbest, smartest man she's ever known. There are sometimes. So I had this, I got this electric smoker I was talking about.
That's when you look at your wife and say, yeah, but you married me.
Oh, she knows. She's, right. She contends she was drunk for a long
under
time.
Under the influence. Yes.
So I got this electric smoker. I just show you my, smartness here.
Electric smoker.
Oh, dude, it's great. No, it's not vaping.
For smoking meat?
Yeah.
An electric smoker.
Well, yeah.
No, you get a regular real smoker with wood chips and
You use wood chips in an electric smoker.
No, and your you grill. Use wood chips. And your bricks.
Yeah, I don't have enough time. I got kids running around. I don't have enough time.
You just don't plug the fucker in and create smoke. Well, I still have
to check. Jeff was here. Jeff, you saw me. I had to turn it. I went out there and checked
he
it.
He went out
and kept filling up chips.
You had to plug it in. No. No, you can't. Here's the funny thing. So you have to start it up before the first time you have to... You know, preheat it for 2 hours, just like get everything going. Then you turn it off, cool, and then you can do your first cooking. Well, after about an hour and a half, I go back out there. I'm like, it's only 65 degrees in here. This doesn't make sense. Oh, shit. I forgot to turn it on. I got the temperature. Didn't hit start.
Ah, great. Again, wow, it's colder in the smoker than it is outside.
Yes. I plugged it in.
It was plugged in. Shut up.
See, and you actually had the light briquettes or something.
I got apple wood chips, thank you very much.
You just dump them in. You're not lighting them up. You're plugging the damn thing in.
You know what? You're plugged in. That's all.
Well, he's just not allowed to eat from your smoker.
That's right.
So you got that a doesn't sound right. You got the microwave smoker.
You know, fuck you. Anyway, so I made wings with a nice rub on it. Jeff, good, what do you think?
Good rub.
Thank you. So there you go. So fuck you, Blake.
Did you make your own rub?
I learned it from a cookbook, one of the smoker cookbooks. So
he learned it by watching you.
I learned it by watching you.
Well, then you got some points back.
The good news is I did not burn the house down, so that was a positive.
The house not burned down, and the wings weren't burnt either.
No, well, no.
It's kind of hard when you got a plug-in.
Well, it does
burn
say
the
to,
house down.
It does say to move.
There is no real flame or anything. It's just like hot coils on a stove.
No.
But
there's smoke.
But you put chips on top of the hot coils.
No. See, and then the chips burn.
Ooh, they burn. Smolder.
I hate you all. Anyways, we're on nerdly.co.uk for you chaps over there.
No, and we're talking not. About smoking is American no. barbecue.
We're talking about vaping.
No, vaping. That's vaping.
Boysenberry. And we're also on Tangent Bound Network, Wicket Radio Network, which every time I type it into my browser, I always go Wicket from the Ewoks. I always need to fix it.
Oh, you put with a T.
Yeah. Musingsofageek.com.
I always think you're playing like that polo thing where you're hitting balls through wickets.
Good day, mate. That's yes. Australian.
It's Australia.
Yeah. Never get hurt.
Can't so wait. Speaking of Australia, how did the
New Zealand won?
Go All Blacks.
Rugby.
All Blacks.
Rugby.
And that's because they all wear all black.
Yes.
I'm just trying to, you know, cut all the complaints off when they hear fags and blacks and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, we're actually using real language from
we're actually UK. Using international vocabulary.
Yes.
So all you wankers can go ahead and jelly good yourself off.
Pumazila sent us a couple memes.
Okay.
Football, aka soccer, is 90 minutes pretending you're hurt. Rugby is 80 minutes pretending you're not. So she said that's how you explain rugby. Rugby, the only sport with short shorts, a dance routine, and violence that scares NFL players. So, and there's a meme of them dancing in short shorts when they scored a goal or a touchdown or whatever it is.
Oh, yeah, they do this.
Then rugby players actually tackle.
Yes.
Yeah, NFL
Stop!
Players don't tackle.
Oh, that one guy on Seattle got tackled.
I didn't see that play.
And then, you talking about
the guy that got hurt his neck?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Lockett? Ricardo Lockett for Seattle? Is that what you're talking about?
Is that who it was?
You talking about the guy that was injured in Dallas-Seattle
game?
Yes. Yeah, it's Ricardo Lockett, the wide receiver.
Mm-hmm.
Ricardo?
Yeah.
Oh, they got two Locketts on their team?
I don't know. Is it Richard Lockett?
Well, there isn't there a Taylor Lockett?
No, it is Ricardo, then.
The one guy that got his neck messed up.
Yeah. But anyway, so Pumazila did link us a YouTube video of how they won, so I will be posting that on our Facebook page, at The History of Bad Ideas.
They won by scoring more points than the other
team. I don't know how, but she has a link. So that's your rugby thing, I think. That's our rugby update.
Oh.
Did they have a lot of scrotums in that game?
Scrums.
Oh, sorry. Well, I'm sure there is a lot of scrotums in it, too. But
probably 22 of them.
Yeah, I'm going with that.
At least.
So, there's your rugby update. Blake, did you watch Walking Dead?
Yes.
And? Spoilers for the next couple minutes.
This episode would have been great to start the season off with.
Yeah, I would have been fine with that, too.
Because, what's his name?
Morgan.
Morgan shows up. Mm-hmm. At the end of last season,
mm-hmm.
after Rick just killed that guy,
yep.
and Morgan's like, oh, life is precious. Whack, we whacked that guy. Oh, shit. I think it would have been a good episode to start off or do like a segue into the beginning of the season. But naturally, I looked at my DVR and it said 1 hour and 30 minutes. I said, oh, is this the finale or the halfway point? Mm-hmm. And as soon as it started, I said, oh, shit.
Yeah.
We're going to be introduced to another character. We're going to build him up for another hour and a half. And he's going to die and it's not going to move the storyline at all whatsoever. However, it was a good story.
I loved the story. I thought it was great. It's Morgan learning how to get past post-traumatic stress disorder. Not get past it, but cope with it.
And explain how he's a badass with that pole.
Yeah, Aikido? Yeah. Is that what it's called?
Aikido.
Yeah, Aikido. He finds a guy that lives in the woods. Personally, I will have lived in that cabin the rest of my life. I will have built the perimeter. You have everything you need. I'm done. I don't need anything else.
Did he have a woman?
No.
He had a goat.
You have a hand.
That was named Tabitha.
Yeah, I wonder
it
what...
It kind of made you scratch your head.
His mentor... Eastman.
Yeah,
I wonder what he did with that goat. I'm thinking there were some good lonely times there. I did think it was funny that they had a lot of Ninja Turtle references. Eastman, Kevin Eastman, the guy that created it. The guy was in robes sometimes, kind of like Splinter.
Well, when you first see him, he was in a tan bathrobe.
Yep. And then he had a shirt that said Save the Terrapins. So, see?
I get
as soon
it
as I was watching that, I was like, oh, I wonder if Eastman... And first thing I think of when I hear Eastman is Kevin Eastman from the Turtles.
I think the Kodak.
Oh, that's a good one, too. For us, it's the Turtle. And then they started talking about that on The Talking Dead, like, oh, I think it's a Turtle reference. I was like, thank you. At least I wasn't the only idiot that thought that.
Oh, that
so was there a Laird on there, too?
A what?
A Laird?
A Laird?
What's the that? Other
oh,
guy?
Oh, the other guy.
Eastman
no, there
and
was,
Laird?
I don't think there was. No.
There wasn't any pizza references.
I did like... No, there wasn't. I did like how he... I was expecting Eastman's mom... Or, I mean, his wife and daughter, and I didn't know he had a son until he told it. I was expecting them to become zombies. I did not expect it to be a convict that broke out of jail, you know, that got out of jail and killed them. That was a shocker.
Well, he avoids coming outright and saying that
correct
he killed the guy, but you still sit there and go, dude, why in the hell do you have a jail cell in your cabin?
Yeah.
That's fucked up, man.
I thought he built it after the zombie apocalypse just in case. And then he started to explain.
Yeah.
I was like, oh.
Weird.
Yeah.
Weird.
I thought he was the guy that played him was awesome. He did a great job.
Yeah, it was good.
I love the story that he basically let the convicts or the criminal starved to death for 47 days.
He finally admitted it.
Yeah.
At the very end. And that's when he has his regret.
Yeah. I thought it was dumb how he died. Oh, I'm going to push you out of the way.
Oh, no. This slow-moving zombie is coming at you.
I think Morgan was actually...
Trying to commit suicide.
I think
so, too.
And he stepped in to save him, and he got bit. And then Morgan became upset because that bite was supposed to be for him.
Mm-hmm.
Blah, blah, blah.
I like the story. I thought it was a very good standalone
episode. It was a great standalone episode.
It probably was one of my favorites the last couple seasons.
Yeah, but not the one to follow up with what happened to Rick and what happened to Glenn.
We actually have a listener
feedback later.
Here. Yeah, we'll talk about it.
It's called foreshadowing.
Yeah, we're
going to get baiting you guys to listen even more.
From Kevin and Chris at 365, and I got some issues with Glenn. So.
Yeah, I got some issues too.
Did anybody see the Preacher trailer?
I saw it. It looks interesting.
I've never seen
the graphic novel,
The graphic novel is amazing.
All right, so I went to...
Jeff, I'm going to need that back from you. I'm going to need them back next week so I can read them again. Then I'll let you borrow them.
But I just started reading it.
Oh, you did you?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll let you finish. Well, once you get done with the novels, bring them back.
Get done next week.
I'm about halfway through the first graphic novel.
Do you like it?
Eh.
Okay, it gets better.
I'm hoping it gets better.
It's not for everybody. That's the thing. And people are like, well, if you're a religious zealot, you won't like it. Not that you are, Jeff. I know. But then it also has an acquired taste, and it is very different than what most people... And so you either love it or hate it.
All right. So here, somebody that doesn't know anything about Preacher. The preview got shoved down my throat along with Into the Badlands for about 1,000 times.
Can we...
But hold on. We'll do Badlands later. So I watched the Preacher thing, and it's like a little boy saying, hey, Preacher, dude, beat up my daddy.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, what the fuck? So I don't understand what the trailer's about or what the main story's about other than a preacher that kicks ass. So I go to IMDb and it basically says, a preacher due to a supernatural event at his church enlists the help of a vampire to find God.
Yes. And his ex-girlfriend.
And that's the only thing it says in IMDb.com.
The preacher's ex-girlfriend who's a hit woman, a.k.a. arms dealer.
See, I didn't even know there's a woman involved.
And... The preacher gets the voice, or what does he get?
Some
voice of God or something.
Some
thing.
Yeah. So, some
Holy Spirit thing.
Oh, I don't even remember.
Evoke the deal.
And whatever he, if he uses it, he can like tell, he like in one part of the book, he tells one of the bad guys, he's on an island. Mm-hmm. I want you to count every piece of sand on every grain of sand. And so the guy has to do it because it's just
whatever
the word of God.
Whatever he commands.
Oh my God, it's like a Bene Gesserit from Dune.
I don't know, dude. No,
when sorry. They use the voice. When the Bene Gesserits use the voice.
Do they have to do anything?
They make people.
That's what this is, basically. And he tells the one guy, walk until you can no longer walk anymore. And the guy walks across the country.
Gump.
Yeah. Yes, but he was a bad guy.
Forrest Gump was inspired by The Preacher.
I think so. But The Preacher is a very good story. It's fucked up. I don't know how they're going to do it. I was okay with the trailer. It kind of reminded me of Justified, and I hope it's not. But not saying anything bad about Justified, but I don't need it. That I need it to be Preacher.
If you want to watch Justified, you watch Justified.
Yeah, I really need it to be Preacher, the graphic novel.
I always watch the Justified commercials,
mm-hmm.
and I always thought they looked really cool.
I've never seen it either.
But I never watched Justified.
I mean, either. I get everything I get from the commercials.
Oh, yeah, that looks really cool.
All right, so let's discuss Justified since none of us has actually seen it.
Okay. Fun fact of the day, Walter Goggins? Who's in it? Who's in Justified? The skinny guy. Walter Goggins?
Timothy Oliphant?
Huh? Oh. Well, yeah, but the other guy.
Walter I have no Goggins. Clue who else
okay,
is in
Walter
it.
Goggins. Anyways, he's the one in Sons of Anarchy, plays the cross-dresser.
Oh, okay.
Anyways, he was in Major League 3, Back to the Minors.
I never saw Major League 3.
Just to let you guys know.
It's one of those movies I try to block out from my memory.
So, well, fun fact of the day. Yeah. But anyways, yeah, I really hope Preacher is good. I don't have much faith in Seth Rogen. I am going to watch it because I really hope it's good. I know it's going to veer off a little bit from, you know, from the graphic novels, but we'll see. One of the bad guys in a bad guy group is they're trying to protect the descendants of Jesus Christ. And they basically have the
Priory of Sion.
Well, they have a version of Jesus, like Jesus's kin, but they've been so wrong. They've been inbreeding through their own bloodline the kid is, you know, just mentally challenged completely. Like all he does is drool, and so they're like, we can't show him to the world as a Jesus. So it's very odd.
We can't show him as a savior.
Yeah. So yeah, it's a weird, weird, weird book. So anybody watch The Flash?
I did.
Do you like it? I love The Flash.
I like it. I don't love it.
Oh, I love it. It's so awesome. They had King Shark. The shark at the end. The king.
His name is King Shark?
Yeah, he is. Yeah.
I thought it was Mako.
I think it's King Shark in the comic books.
I thought it was Kingpin.
No, not Kingpin. It doesn't matter. Yeah. Anyways, they have a guy who has a shark.
With a freaking laser beam attached.
No, he didn't have a laser beam. Oh. But I did get a quick Twitter account thing here at Bad Ideas from Doug, number one fan. Did Jay Garrick in The Flash just refer to Aquaman on The Flash? #, you should be watching.
Yeah, it's on right now as we're recording. So.
I think he might have.
Damn it.
So, anything else you guys want to talk about? Nothing? Okay, let's go to listener feedback.
I don't know. I could talk about how I schooled you on our Facebook discussion earlier today.
Okay, go ahead and talk about this real quick.
Was there an education thing?
No, I just put up a silly little meme, you know, forwarded one on Facebook. A little picture of R2-D2 that says, knows who Luke's father is, never tells him.
Oh, yeah. That's right. The prick never tells him or something like that. Yeah,
Jeff came and found out, though.
So then a friend of ours gets on and is like, doesn't everybody remember? I mean, they had the droids mind wiped, their memory erased at the end of episode 3. And I'm like, no, they erased 3PO's memory, not R2's.
I thought he did say droids.
And
I thought they tried to wipe R2's memory clean, but they had the glitch with the Princess Leia message in it, and therefore they didn't succeed.
Well, that glitch was 23 years later.
He's talking Attack of the Clone or Revenge of the Sith.
Oh, yeah. I was getting my 4 mixed up with 3.
Most people forget the other prequels, so it's okay.
But and Jason's like, yeah, both droids. And then I got like SmackDown. I'm like, that's not right. I mean, I only saw it once, but I distinctly remember It was only 3PO.
The protocol.
Yeah, so I looked it up, and he says, you know, clean the droids up and have the protocol droids mind wiped. And I'm like, see, protocol droid, only one. So screw you.
We and the horse you rode in.
But wait, C-3PO is the protocol droid.
Yeah. Yes.
3PO
not
R2-D2. Has the mind.
Correct.
Not
R2. So R2-D2 still
R2
do.
Knows it.
Yeah, he just never told him.
R2 knows that Luke's dad is Anakin, is Darth Vader, and doesn't tell him.
My question is, what happened to R2-D2's robot?
Does R2 understand who Luke Skywalker is?
I don't know, but we're going to say yes.
Maybe.
Can we?
We don't know.
Say yes? Yeah,
he understands
yes.
Other things. Apparently feels pain when he gets shot.
Everybody can understand dot beeps. Beep, 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 beep. Oh, really, R2? Lassie's in the well? But I'm wondering what happened to his robot, the rocket boosters from
they fell off. He got gangrene and they fell off.
He ran out of fuel.
He definitely became much less impressive in the trilogy, original. If you're going by a timeline.
Yeah, by timeline, I think all technology kind of took a step back because once Palpatine took control, you know, advancements in science just stopped.
Yeah.
And
except for Death Stars.
Except for Death Star advancement, because that's where all the money went.
And they had to make that vent. They had to make the vent.
Well, of course you need a vent.
Reactor.
Yes.
You need a vent.
It overheats.
If it overheats, it blows up by itself.
Completely exposed.
It's like a smoker. It was an electric smoker.
Completely exposed. You needed to have a missile take a 90-degree turn, which is physically impossible.
Oh, my God. And then after the first one, you make the vent large enough for a Millennium Falcon to fly into it.
Okay, that was just stupid. That's just stupid to lure him there.
This little vent with 90-degree turns. We'll just make anybody fly straight into the core.
Maybe they ran out of money. They ran out of funding. Maybe their Death Star levy didn't pass at the ballot box.
Those years of war, all those pension benefits they had to pay out.
Maybe there was a strike with the contractors. Fuck you, Emperor!
Yeah, after a certain point in time of loaning money out and working on deficits, they couldn't afford to close that gap.
Could you imagine Darth Vader walking in? What do you need, Master? Emperor's at the little calculator. Hold on, I'm loading the bills. Hold on, I'm trying to figure this out.
I just want to see some little ships flying around the Death Star with picket line. With little strike signs.
Then you see R2-D2 flying with his rockets. Yeah. Still here!
You will not raise the interest rate.
Dick Cheney, is that you? Hey, Dick, come on over here. I want to see that movie now, Palpatine the Bookkeeper.
There will be no sequestration.
Disney's going to have so many offshoots and spin-offs, you might as well make him be the Bookkeeper. It's like Ebenezer Scrooge.
You will buy treasury bills.
War bonds. Kings do war bonds. We're doing a fundraiser on PBS this week. We need to get that little opening closed off. Can you help?
Please send in your donations, and you'll get a free tote bag
with the Sith logo.
You know, Mr. Vader, you're raising our liability insurances every time you and disability insurances every time you cut somebody's limbs off.
Just relax on that. If you pledge two.
It's a sanitary cut at birds and seals at the same time.
So if you donate $250 to the PBS fund drive right now, we will give you a meet and greet with the Darth Vader one, the Lord of the Sith.
The Emperor fund drive.
Yes.
And if you put $500 in, we'll put your name on a piece of steel on the outside of the Death Star.
Ooh. It's a little tile. Mom, Pa, Collins. Yay!
We'll give you a little patch on the stormtrooper outfit.
This stormtrooper is sponsored by Bob Smith.
That's right.
Yo, Smith. It's a little Jamaican flag. That's kind of fun. Look at that. You get to design your logo. I like it. Let's do it.
There you go.
Come on, Disney.
Well, after the liability insurance, when the first Death Star blew up with all the civilians on it, and all the death compensation we had to pay out.
We're still in litigation about that. Fucking Elk and Elk.
Oh, Elk and Elf.
No. Lloyds of Palpatine was it?
Tatooine. Lloyds
of Tatooine denied her claim because they considered it a war liability, a war casualty.
All the
it was an act of God since it was a Jedi that blew it up.
There you go.
Wait a minute, aren't you guys have media chlorines?
No, shut up, we don't have those! Those don't count. Fuck you, Lucas.
The State Department tried to blame it on a video made by the Ewoks on one of the moons of Endor. They,
Fucking it, Ewoks. They always fuck things up. Anyways, listener feedback.
All right.
All right, back to our structured program. Listener feedback, starting off with
Doug.
Number one fan, Doug.
Can't give yourself a nickname.
He says, how much does the Peanuts make in opening week? I think he's asking for a prediction. And will this revitalize the franchise?
Randall Holt, RJ Holt 666, had to answer that. No. That was his answer.
Well, I'm sure that no was to the will it revitalize the franchise.
I think that's the money.
How much does it make?
No. I bet it makes more than Gem and the Holograms.
I bet you're right. I'm saying 32 million.
Okay, Jeff is going 32 million. Blake, how much are you going with?
I just don't feel right. There's no Charles Schultz involved.
I know, but.
But his son is.
Whatever.
Yeah, his son is involved.
Charles can't be involved.
I was like, who really cares about this? But my son is really excited about this. And I'm kind of shocked that, you know, people are talking about it. I'm going 24 million. I hope more, but anything that gets the Peanuts and Charlie Brown back on my screen in the social awareness is fine by me.
All right, so Jeff, you have how many?
I have 32.
32 million.
I'm going 24 million. Don't go $1. This isn't right.
I'm going $1.
Okay.
We're allowed to go over. It's just who's ever the closest.
He's going $1.
I'm going $1.
Would you like to go 1 million? Would that make it better?
No, I would do $32 million and 1 cent.
Okay.
I thought you were going to go one cent under what Jason said.
Or I could go 24 million and 1 cent. No. And work for that in-between shot from you guys.
I like it. Oh. Or you can go, hey.
22,999,099 cents.
I hope it does well. I don't know, though. I'm going to be intrigued by it if it does. I don't know what else starts this week. We have it in box office. Spectre. Spectre opens.
Spectre.
Bond.
A lot of kids are going to go see Spectre.
Yes.
Yeah, they did say
Spectre is huge on the 6 to 9 crowd.
Yes. Spectre did make
6 to 9 crowd.
More like the 69 crowd.
Oh!
Talk about the 60 to 90 crowd.
Spectre did open with the biggest box office in UK history, 80 million.
Oh, no, in the UK this past week?
In the week, yeah, I guess.
Not here?
Yeah. Wow, 80 million in the UK, that is like, huge.
For the whole week,
that's like a gazillion US dollars.
Yeah. So, okay, next.
He said, how do Cisco and Caitlin make a living?
The Flash.
Star Labs doesn't make any money.
Jeff?
Government grants.
Who's Cisco and Caitlin?
They work for The Flash, Barry Allen, in the TV show The Flash.
They're scientists.
They're on grants.
Yeah,
university grants.
Government, I think.
Government. Okay. I don't think it's a university.
Well, grants come from the university.
I keep waiting for them to build Star Labs up more, and I think they will this year. But I'm like, you do have all these criminals in the basement, and who's taking care of them? There's only three people working there.
They still have them, do they?
I think so.
I thought the end of last season, like, didn't all the criminals escape and they
decided but they got some back.
I thought they decided not to keep them there. Because now that everyone knows about the metahumans, they actually have real jail to hold metahumans.
That's right. You're right, because Iris's father made a comment about that. That's right. Okay. You're correct. I just hope that more people start working there and, you know, make it more.
Well, more people will. I mean, come on. They got a new... Well, he's going off, isn't he? I'm going to say they got a new... what
Flash?
You call it?
Blow thing. Okay.
Yeah.
Moving
What's
on.
His name? The nuclear man.
Firestorm.
Firestorm. Yeah. But then he left, didn't he?
Yeah, they left. He's going to Legends
of
Tomorrow.
He's going to Legends of Tomorrow.
I'm out, bitches. See ya. I do like Captain Cold in that show. He is one of my favorite characters.
Wentworth Miller?
Yeah, he is doing awesome.
He's leaving.
Yeah, he's going to Legends
he's going
tomorrow.
To Legends of Tomorrow.
So, next.
Yeah, you know, these reality question things about comic books, you know, really irritate me.
I'm sorry.
Just leave it to make-believe.
Well, yeah, but it does kind of bother me, too. It really does. It's like when there's a fight in a person's apartment or something, a house, I'm like, who's going to clean that up afterwards? Exactly. Like, I think that. I go, who's cleaning that up? It may be my OCD, but I'm like, who the fuck's picking that up?
Or like in Friends, you sit there and look at it. How can they afford that apartment? It's so huge.
Prostitution. Yeah, I'm telling you. Chandler Bing was a prostitute.
Oh, it was rent controlled. It was her mother's, and they were illegally staying on under her mother's name.
Is that what it was?
Or her grandmother, I should say.
Is that what it was?
But yeah, it was rent controlled since the 50s, and they did actually address it because they wanted to complain to the super, and the super said something about, oh, yeah, that's the apartment where, you know, the two young girls are living under the rent control. Oh, I can report that. And they're like, oh, we have no problems.
I see nothing.
And by the way, stop by my apartment wearing something light.
And Joey does.
I
see.
I like sandwiches. Watch my new show.
Try it. Bring one of them shimmies.
Next.
From Snake Oil Comics at SOC Podcast. Do you think Jar Jar Binks makes the Ewoks look like Shaft?
No, because Jar Jar Binks is the ultimate evil in the Star Wars universe.
It's going to be shown up in the J.J. Abrams ending in the movies.
I saw someone expounded on the theory I threw out there earlier, and I'm like, sweet, that's even more than I even thought about it.
Jar Jar Binks is evil. That's how I go into the prequels. That's what I think.
That's how I assume when I watch it.
He was working for Palpatine the whole time. Nobody can be that stupid. Any alien species. Nothing.
That's what they're saying. You know, when he's jumping around and falling over and yet killing everybody. Drunken Master Kung Fu.
Yep. I agree.
Master Jedi. All right. The Pulp Culture Cafe at TPC Cafe.
What's that old boot?
Yeah. What's your specialty drink there at the Pulp Culture Cafe? Can you make a nice latte?
Canadian mousse. It's really good.
Is that like chocolate mousse?
With real mousse in it.
Oh.
It's kind of, it's really delicacy.
They probably serve Canada Dry.
Yeah, ginger ale. Yeah.
With Canadian whiskey.
I like it.
Yes.
I think Nichols' favorite drink out there is Molson. I think he's a big Molson fan. I think so.
All right.
They probably have round bacon, too.
They take
It's not really bacon. It's just thin ham.
Really?
Yeah.
They take Canadian Tire Money, too.
Don't understand the Canadian Tire Money.
Nobody in Canada even does.
Oh, my God.
I understand the pound a lot better than Canadian money, Tire Money.
That's like 70 episodes ago. We had that as a running joke.
Pam Morris will get us caught up.
So, Pop Culture Cafe with their funny round bacon and Canada Dry ginger ale say, hey, have you seen Ash vs. Evil Dead? Thoughts?
I did not. Anybody?
I have. Purposely recorded it because I like Bruce Campbell.
Mm-hmm.
I like The Evil Dead and Army of Darkness. And I watched it, and I liked it.
Good.
It's got Sam Raimi's back, you know, doing it. And, you know, Bruce is producing it.
And it's Bruce, so.
And it's kind of funny, but it starts off with him having sex in a bar with an old lady. And the sex jokes are kind of funny, but it's not Evil Dead-ish kind of jokes. So it's like a little more, it's like they try to go for an adult.
So they don't have a rapey tree?
Here. Oh, God, I hope they don't have a rapey tree.
No, but I like it. Now, there's other main characters that are going to be involved in this plot, from what I understand, from the first episode.
How many episodes is it?
I don't know.
I think 10?
It's like 10 episodes. I don't know. It's like a 10-episode
I don't have
series.
Stars, so I stopped even caring about
You're
it.
You're a star in my eye.
Aww.
Nah, I can't back that up. No, I
liked it. I'm going to keep watching it.
I'm going to binge watch it one night.
You can probably do that, yeah.
I think once the whole series is done, or a season is done.
That's right. Just make sure the kids are asleep for the first scene.
I will.
First episode. Well,
No. My kid hasn't seen Phantom Menace. That's pretty scary, too. Mm-hmm. So I've refused to throw that one out there.
Really?
He hasn't seen it.
Phantom Menace is scary?
Yeah, it's how awful it is. I'm kidding!
Scary on how bad it is. Okay.
Next.
Pam Moore's at Pam World. She's on episode 56.
It's slowly going through them. Good for you, Pam. Thank you.
She heard 50 Shades was a Twilight fan fiction 2. Reading the book, she didn't see it. However, watched the movie, and yes, it is.
Oh. Has anyone seen 50 Shades of Grey yet?
No.
Okay. Has anyone seen the YouTube, the nudity from 50 Shades of Grey?
What?
The nudity in it, just to see. Oh, okay. No. I mean, I was just wondering if anyone else has. Was it worth it?
Can you YouTube nudity? I thought you weren't allowed to put nudity.
You might Google YouTube. It.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Okay.
Google it. Okay, my
Google
bad. It.
Google nudity. See what comes up. I have a hunch.
50 Shades of Grey won't be the first thing.
Yeah, do that on your computer, not mine.
You may be searching an awful lot.
Don't be using that on my computer.
You know, it's kind of funny. He's talking about search histories. A friend of mine has a young son.
Mm-hmm.
And for a while, he's wondering about his young son's possible sexual orientation, mm-hmm. which he'd be fine with no matter what.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, whoa, is he going to be straight, or maybe he has inclinations to be,
mm-hmm.
you know, gay or whatever. And he's like, and then I saw his search history on Google, and it was boobs, boobies, boobs, 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 boobs. He's like,
boobs.
Yeah, I
boobs,
think he's gonna be straight.
More boobies.
Unless they say male boobies in front.
Yeah, I know. No.
What do we got, Jeff, for Google nudity?
Well, the first thing comes up is nudity, the Wikipedia article on nudity.
Oh, that's gonna be thrilling.
Then videos about nudity on Vimeo.
Oh, that can't be good on Vimeo.
Then Screen Rant's 15 TV shows with the most nudity. Followed by Channel 7 airs full frontal nudity during midday movie. From the Daily Mail in UK.
Oh, those bloody wankers.
Then why is Playboy giving up nudity? Opinion poll.
This is quite disappointing on the nudity Google.
Should I go to Google Images and see what nudity
comes
up?
Yeah, let's see what that does.
I had such higher expectations for low results.
Oh, oh, there's nudity.
You don't want to see this image.
What's the first image?
Just turn look.
There we go. When you Google image nudity, that's what you get.
I think I can see her ovaries. No,
nothing to the imagination.
Maybe
there.
I'll turn safe search on.
Do you have safe search on?
I didn't. I will turn it on now and see what comes up.
Put the parental.
Oh, Daenerys Targaryen comes up.
I can't remember
when you put safe search on.
It even gets better.
There's your fun fact for nudity.
And looking at that makes me think of 365 Flicks Podcast.
Oh, they do have a bloody good time of nudity over there.
365 Flicks Pod.
Yes.
How are you going to feel when we find Glenn is alive? I am sickened how they have handled this.
Glenn's dead. Walking Dead.
Glenn's dead. Dead. He's dead. He's dead, dead, dead.
He was not in the credits for this past week's episode. Did you see that?
That's right. And he wasn't on the talking couch.
Yeah, he's not dead.
He's dead, 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 dead. But you will see him.
Oh, he's not dead. He's undead.
No. You will see him in flashback and sideways episodes, but he is dead, dead, dead.
I don't think so.
I don't think so.
I think he crawled under the...
You know what? They could do that crazy shit again like they did last time when he was outside mm-hmm. the fence facing off with his buddy. What was that guy? I forget what his
Douchebag
name.
Galore? I don't know.
Galore who off
is
himself.
That, is that Pussy's brother?
Yes, Pussy Galore's brother, Douchebag Galore.
You know, when Glenn had three walkers on top of him and he's fighting them off, you're like... And they ended it right there. You're like, oh shit, what the hell happened? And then Glenn shows up at the gates with the boy and
hey,
buddy.
How's it going?
Glenn's brains aren't good enough for the zombies.
Yeah, maybe they're picky. They don't like him.
Or maybe he has
too
anti-zombie sweat or something where they're not going after him.
You know, the funny thing is they're not going to show what happened in this episode either. Well, next week's episode is not.
Not at all.
It's about the inside of the community.
They gave away the showrunner said, no, Rick doesn't lose his hand. It's bandaged up. And everybody's like, oh, so that means Rick is still alive.
Because
he was in the RV.
Correct, and the zombies were attacked. Zombies
Rick is still alive. They're not going to kill Rick off.
This it would be awesome Game if they
Thrones.
Did.
If they did, it'd be Game of Thrones, this kind of thing.
I think Glenn's still alive. I think Rick's still alive.
Rick's still alive. Glenn's dead.
If
dead.
They come dead, up dead, with something dead, ridiculous dead. For Glenn, I would almost lose respect for the show.
I think you have to.
Because of the way he died.
Glenn is actually an alien.
Shut
and
up.
Zombies don't want aliens.
Shut up! You're six seasons behind. Shut up.
Glenn is so famished that they don't like his.
Or he's
blood.
A robot.
Oh, yeah.
He's a robot, so he can't be turned.
Oh, he's like Johnny Five.
Okay, I was going to say more like Lieutenant Commander Data, but Johnny Five works.
No, Lieutenant Dane? Lieutenant Dane! I got no legs!
Oh, yeah.
And Glenn doesn't have any legs. It ate him. I got no legs. I think he survives. And I'll tell you one thing. I think it's going to have a big pushback from the fan base. They're going to be pissed. But I think it would be awesome if they did come back and he's dead. Yeah. But there's been set photos of like episode 8 and 9 where he's out talking to the new guys that are coming into the community. It's like, oh, really? I hope he's not alive. So, I don't know. Next.
Dr. Number One says, forest moon of Endor. Is the moon called Endor or is the planet that it orbits?
I've always questioned that too.
I've never known.
Yeah, they always say the forest moon of Endor.
Yeah, I thought it was forest moon of Endor. Yeah.
So does that mean it's the moon of Endor that's the forest? Is it the forest moon
of Endor?
Of Endor. Because they do refer to it as Endor and other things, I believe.
They do.
I think it's Endor, but yes, I think the wording is a little weird. Yeah, the forest moon of Endor. Yeah. Okay.
Well, let's see what Wikipedia says.
Nudity. No, nudity. Not that.
Don't click on the images.
I don't think that's an Ewok. That's an Ewok nude.
Endor, also known as the forest moon of Endor.
There you go.
And the sanctuary moon was a small forested moon orbited the gas giant planet of Endor. So it's both, apparently.
It's like New York, New York?
Yes.
Endor. Yay!
The forest moon of Endor.
Yeah.
Well, apparently the planet's a gas giant, though.
Oh,
it's
Jupiter.
But the moon is the farthest moon away from it.
So that's why it's solid.
Ah.
It's in that special
zone. So I'm more confused by reading this than I was before going in.
Can we get that one scientist guy,
Neil deGrasse Tyson?
Yeah. Can he answer this?
Yeah, let's. I'll try and tweet him about
that. Okay, thank you. We also have a special last thing for listener feedback. We don't have a draft day this week, but good old Henno, Blake's pod lover.
El Henno.
He sent in the new draft day theme music, and we have to play it. You ready? You want to hear it?
But we don't have any drafts.
It's all right. I just want to give him props for taking the time to do this. And then next week when we do a draft, we can do it.
Well, we're previewing the song this week. And then we'll put it into full rotation
next week. I just want to make sure everybody likes it.
So it's kind of like your new bride saying, hey, this is my wedding night outfit.
Mm-hmm.
Don't touch me.
Okay.
It's kind of like that. Yes.
Kind of like that.
And it's a tease, as you always say. We're teasing.
Yes.
For next week.
Come on.
So this is the El Henno dick tease.
If anyone's going to tease, it's Henno.
All right. Here we go.
What do we want? Draft day! Draft day, draft day, I want a draft day.
Hobi.
Draft day, we need a draft day.
Hobi, history, bad ideas,
yeah! Draft day!
Oh, Henno, love it.
Well done, Henno, well done.
Gold star for you. Hell, he might be up for Canadian of the Year.
Can we put... He's from Idaho.
Idaho's close. They border.
Okay, Henno's up for Canadian of the Year. Canadian of the Year. You know what? We're going to have a big competition for the floppy song of the year.
Ooh.
We got a couple songs. Ooh. We got the opening. We got the closing. We got draft day. We got any other ones?
We got face off.
Face off, yes. I want to take your face off. So Nicolas Cage is up for that.
Or anything that Jason sings.
Oh, wow, then you're going to lose on that one. It's my life, it's now or never. Thank you, Henno. Next week, we are doing...
I wonder how many hours he spent on that.
He said he figured it out driving in the car, so it was a pretty quick one, I think.
He didn't say it was driving from Oregon or from Portland.
Yeah. Next week, we did get a request for draft day. They wanted us to do Con Air.
Oh, someone hates me.
That would be number one fan, Doug. So Con Air, that's what we're doing next week. We're drafting Con Air. I think we need to bring Morrison for that.
Well, we can, yeah.
So... There you go, and so we will unveil the full rotation of the music will be in next week.
I don't think I've actually seen Con Air in its entirety.
Neither do the script writers, so it's okay.
I'm not going to watch it between now and next
week. You should, it's a classic.
No, I'm not.
Blake, I'm sure your casting will probably beat out those of us who have seen it.
Okay.
I mean, you'll probably get the kite-eating tree again.
Yes. So I think we're on for News of the Geek.
It's time for a new installment of the news of the geek.
Okay. Still on a high here for that draft day theme. Pretty excited about it.
Yeah, it's kicking the shit out of my news of the geek.
If anybody else had theme songs they want to send in that they made, go ahead. Well, we still need a news of the geek. We could have a new one, you know. But I do like you doing it. But if somebody has a song.
We still need top five.
Top five songs.
We're still using sleazy lawyer music, commercial music for.
Yes. So if we could do something on that. And listener feedback. So if anybody has it, send it to us at thehistoryofbadideas@gmail.com or on Twitter.
Bad Ideas. They want a floppy.
Podcast. Yes. This is exciting. Ocean's 11 is getting a gender swapped reboot starring Sandra Bullock.
Is that a reboot?
It's Canadian. It leads an all-female crew in the new heist movie. The Playlist reports that a rumored female Oceans film will have Sandra Bullock sliding into the George Clooney role, a.k.a. Danny Ocean.
Danielle Ocean.
Oh, God. I didn't even think of that.
Danielle C.
So the question is this a remake of the 2001 show or a remake of the Sinatra movie from the 60s?
That's the big question. We don't know. I'm going to say the George Clooney because Ocean's 11
because that
director.
Was actually good.
George Clooney and Ocean's 11 director Steven Soderbergh and producer Jerry
Weintraub.
Thank you, who passed away earlier this year. We're talking to Sandra Bullock about it. So they are all in on it. I don't know. You know,
there's a. Apparently, there's been a lot of backlash against the
Ghostbusters
mm-hmm. all-female cast because there was an interview with
Kristen Wiig
talking about all the hate mail she's received about it.
Well, if we'll sit here and complain about it.
I don't think Ocean's 11 is dear to many people's hearts as Ghostbusters was.
Well, I'm sorry, no offense, but who's got the time to worry about writing hate mail to Kristen Wiig?
Or hate mail to any actor or actress.
The same people that put that political bullshit up on Facebook.
No, that's true. My thing is, though, I don't hate it because it's, you know, female cast or anything. That's fine. I don't care about that. I have an issue. I think it's lazy, though. Hey, we got a movie. We don't have any ideas. Let's reboot something. Yeah, put all women in it because that's new territory. It's not, though. It's like, do something creative.
Yeah, exactly.
Clever.
With everybody that lives in Los Angeles that's written a fucking script.
Yeah.
Because in order to be a citizen of Los Angeles, you have to have a script. I mean, you just keep coming up with these fucked out ideas.
So my question Reboots. Is, will they pay the women the same thing they paid the men?
They're only going to be stealing
75%.
And will that be 75% of
the 700 million, we're only stealing 75 million. That's what we're owed. How would that go in the boardroom there, Blake? You want to step into this one?
No, I want to step out.
Okay.
But we at Warner Brothers, we want the women teams. They're going and steal the money, and they're sexy doing it.
Why do you sound like a German vampire now?
Why not?
Yeah, okay. How many bikini shots can we fit in there of Sandra Bullock in a bikini stealing the money?
Can it be slow motion first?
Can it be slow motion jiggly?
Yes. Yeah,
can
we
get our agent to sign off to slow motion jiggly?
Can we get the girl that shits in the sink?
Gotta get her.
Okay, gotta get her.
Gotta get the shit sinking girl.
Instead of the sink, she's gonna do it in the fountains at Caesars. She's gonna shit in the fountain at Caesars.
Gotta go big. That's how about she stand in the fountain while she's shitting out one and she's barfing out the other? In the fountain. Hell, that would be brilliant.
And it's like a bidet. It's going up her butt.
And she's standing out there, and it's next to the fountain of actually Caesar spitting water out of his mouth and shit out of his ass.
I like it.
Oh, the juxtaposition.
Oh, it's so deep.
It's called symbolism.
Do you get it? Can we get off?
And by the way, I'm going to need 1,000 hot blondes for casting couch calls.
Yes.
Start signing them up. Hold on a second. I got this book here from the model agency. Bring them all in. 20-minute intervals. And up my Viagra, please.
What role are they up for? Don't worry about it.
Doesn't fucking matter.
Doesn't matter. Okay.
They're up for Vegas Showgirl. Number 1, 2, 3, 78, 79, and 1 million.
Can we get Meryl Streep to do this movie? Right?
Maybe. Wow, actually, Meryl Streep doing an Ocean's movie actually might be intriguing.
Okay, time out. Okay, fans, Hobi fans, tell us who you want in the new Ocean's 11 female cast.
Which 11 women you want.
Or if you do three, that's fine. You don't have to do 11. That's a long list. Amy Schumer, because she's the new thing at the moment, so let's do Schumer.
All right.
That's
She'd take the Brad Pitt role then?
Sure, why not? I don't know. Is she eating? Can she eat a sandwich? No, women can't eat. Let's not do that.
We definitely know we don't want that Jennifer Lawrence bow check.
No, she wants equal pay.
She's already asking, she wants equal pay. Screw that.
Fuck that. They're going for $75 million,
right? Give me the lookalikes. Start booking them now.
Jessica Alba?
That's right. Get my Blake boner.
You think we could... Do you think... How about Hayden Panettiere? Can we get her in?
Can we book her multiple times? She can play a cheerleader. We're going to have to call her back in again and again and again.
And I mean again and again.
Who's tonight? Tara Reid should be open.
Terry, but she has to keep her clothes off.
Yeah. Can we have sharks in it?
I liked her role in the Big Lebowski 2 trailer. Bring her in.
Bring her in. Good call.
I like her versatility.
How about Katherine Heigl? Can we get her in here?
No.
No for you, yes for me.
Buck her three times. Sir, your wife is online.
Hang up.
Buck her three times.
Oh, God. Moving on. Top 10 video games. I'm glad you know, took the high road on that one, Blake. I'm not doing it. Okay, I'm in. Jeff talking like a German Dracula. I'm in.
I had to bring back the ecosystem.
The ecosystem.
There in the casino, the big great ecosystem. And in the middle of the ecosystem, with the rebirth, rejuvenation, and the fertilizer, we got the fat woman in the shitting in the sink.
To fertilize the entire ecosystem.
We will corner the German porn market.
Scheiße.
Scheiße films.
I don't think it's going to take much.
Oh, please bring me back out of the pit.
The two girls in the cup has stood too high, too long at number one in the porn market in Germany. Anyways, top 10 video games coming out in 2016 from Cinema Blend.
Top 10 most anticipated.
From Cinema Blend.
Uncharted 4.
I do like the Uncharted games.
Supposedly the last one.
Supposedly.
I had a syllable.
Yeah, so Chartered 4.
Yes.
That's right.
I'm intrigued by it. It comes out in March. I like it. Mm-hmm. Did you ever buy a PlayStation 4, Blake?
No, I haven't bought anything yet.
Dark Souls 3. Has anyone ever played the Dark Souls games? I heard they're pretty tough.
Dark Souls 3.
Yeah. 3.
Here's the one that I like.
Okay.
Yes. No Man's Sky. June 2016. It's basically you explore planets, and there's no load times. You get into the rocket, and you just go to whatever planet you want. You experience monsters. You know, you can explore.
Can I go to Endor?
Probably. But they said it's pretty much expanding. And the one rumor I heard is that they will let people, the players, create their own planets. So they don't even know what's going to go on in the planets. And, you know, and they have this
sweet stripper planet.
Yeah. And then they also have this algorithm, basically, of the computer.
You are king.
Until your dollar bills run out. Sir, you're going to have to leave the planet.
Until your wife calls you back to reality.
She's on Endor. Go back to it. So I'm intrigued by it. It's basically, they said the universe is so fast and the worlds within it are created as we play. So even the developers aren't positive about what players will come across when the doors are finally opened on the game. So, it looks fun.
That's the one game on this list that makes me want to...
Have you seen the previews for it?
I have not.
You should go online and check out the preview. I'll put a link on our Facebook page
this week. Yes, put a link on our Facebook page.
This is the other one I was talking about with Morris a couple weeks ago, Far Cry Primal, when they go back into...
Primal.
They go back into the Ice Age.
Prequel.
It is. It's Ice Age. I'm intrigued by that. Gravity Rush 2. I have no idea what this is. It's about gravity and rushing it.
Apparently, Gravity Rush was on the PlayStation Vita.
Yes.
Which was the only system it was on, so the 18 people that own one of those know what Gravity Rush
Sony did announce that they are no longer going to make a handheld game systems.
Because the phones have already eclipsed what they can do on...
The technology is superseded.
Yes. Did you see Activision bought Candy Crush creators today, the makers of Candy Crush, like that company.
They bought the creators?
No, they didn't buy the creators, sorry. That's on buy, sell later. Oh, okay. No, they bought the company for $5.9
billion. Wow.
Yeah.
$6 billion for Candy Crush?
I forget how much they were saying that Candy Crush was making per day. I think at one time it was almost just south of $100 million a day with transactions.
Are people still, like, playing it?
Who knows?
At least as frequently as they used to.
That was my biggest pet peeve on Facebook. So-and-so invited you for Candy Crush.
It's an issue when you go up and you have 27 notifications about Candy Crush. I don't care. Go away.
Exactly.
You just tell them you don't want any notifications about Candy Crush. Facebook lets you do that.
No, it doesn't.
Does.
Dislike. It does. Deus Ex, Mankind Divided.
Deus Ex. Now.
Deus Ex.
I'm in a sequel. Colon. Yes.
Electric Piggle.
Now, I have never played the Deus Ex, but I've always wanted to because it's got the Warren Spector guy that did that in the Thief series. And I did, you know, on a side note, too, that Warren, when he left Eidos or whatever, he started his own gaming company. And he was the mastermind behind the Deus Ex and the Thief. And he loved the whole open
concept.
Open world RPG concept and the stealth thing other than the slash them. Or whatever. So I faithfully went to his website like every month for like 3 years. And he kept saying, working on the next big thing. And he talked about he was hiring people and got a contract with Disney. And I went, oh shit.
Oh.
But I have faith because his website at the time would look like a warrior with a shield with a long spear standing in front of a cavern, which had a bridge into a castle thing. It looked very
Dragon Age.
D&D, Dragon Age, RPG-ish. So I kept my hopes up. I'm like, okay, this is the guy that did the Deus Ex that everybody loved that I'm meaning to play, and I haven't gotten around to it. The Thief, you know, that wonderful game and all that kind of stuff. And I've been watching him, and he's posted articles about open world RPG, blah, blah, blah. You know, complete world interaction where you decide the main storyline and blah, 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 blah. I went to his website almost every year, every month for years, and then he comes out with fucking Epic Mickey.
Is that what it was?
Yes.
Oh, that did not get good reviews either.
Epic Mickey?
Yes. Yeah.
That sounds terrible.
Was it horrible? It was,
they did foreshadow when he got the Disney contract, and I still held out hope. But anyways, that's my tangent.
On Tangent Bound Network?
Yeah.
Star Fox Zero?
Zero.
I'm excited about this. Been waiting for a Star Fox.
Never liked Star Fox.
Well, it doesn't like you. On a side note, I did get Disney Infinity 3.0 for my son for Christmas. Got it from It's Free at Last. I was working with her. Bought it, but still, you know, nice deal.
So it wasn't free at
last. Well, it was a nice deal. Anyways, but I also...
Free at last, quote, not everything.
It's where you can add the... You buy the little figures and you can add them in and that. Yeah. My parents got him Falcon... From Marvel Comics, because my dad really liked him. He's like, he looks pretty cool. And they got him, I think, Hulk, Incredible Hulk, because he likes the Incredible Hulk. I got him Spot from Good Dinosaur. Not even out yet. I got a connection. I've got it. And I got, he also gets Anakin with the pack and someone else I forget with it, too. So... I'm intrigued to play. I've never played the Disney Infinity games.
Original Spock or J.J. Abrams?
Spock? No, not Spock. Spot.
Oh, yeah.
From Good Dinosaur. He's the little kid.
Sure.
Well, you know what?
Yeah, I know you've been talking about Good Dinosaur for like a year now.
Yes.
Finally saw a commercial for it.
It looks amazing.
No, it doesn't.
I hope so.
I'm hoping, because I usually give Pixar the benefit of the doubt, but... I think it's giving Cars 2 a run.
No.
That's what it looks like to me.
Nope.
Looks not good.
I wish they would have gone a little bit more detailed on the dinosaurs, because they did such a good job with everything else. But we'll see. Gears of War 4. Slated for the holiday 2016 launch.
Never got into Gears of War.
I played the first two, and they were fun.
It reminded me too much of Pathfinder art. Where people's fists were as big as their heads.
Yeah, it doesn't take it seriously, but yeah, it's like that. Yeah. You have a chainsaw on your gun. Yeah. So there's your games coming out.
That probably works well. When I'm cutting down the tree, I can shoot it too!
Yeah!
Yeah. But you know, Jeff and I were talking about this before. Out of this top 10, nine out of the 10
are sequels. Or prequels. Or
No Man's Land is going to be the big one.
Going the way of Hollywood.
I hope so.
I am excited about Star Wars Battlefront.
Actually, I think it's even worse than Hollywood. I think video it's games. Worse.
Oh, yeah.
Once you get one game out there, Cash Cow, you just run Call sequel of Duty? After sequel. Yeah.
I've even stopped buying those games. The Call of Duty games?
Yeah, because they're not that good.
No, after a while, you're just like, okay, why am I buying this one again?
Well, it's just churning out the same shit.
I did buy my daughter, I told you about a while ago, she bought me Star Wars Battlefront. That comes out in 2 weeks. I'm really excited about that. That looks pretty damn good. So I'll have a review of that probably after Thanksgiving. So, and then finally, Joe Blow states the plot of the next Batman movie will see the debut of the Red Hood.
Now, is this Batman the animated series?
No, this is the
Ben Affleck. Question about.
This is Ben Affleck Batman in 2018.
But I don't understand.
It's going to be...
All right, well, go ahead and keep reading the thing, and I'll show you my questions.
The Red Hood, a.k.a. the resurrected Jason Todd, the second Robin, will be based upon the books Death in the Family, which saw Todd get killed by Joker, and Under the Hood, which he was raised from the dead by the Lazarus Pit from Ra's al Ghul, to seek vengeance against Batman. The movie will also feature Dick Grayson as Nightwing, yes, who will team up with Batman to take on the Red Hood and the Joker. So I'm pretty excited about that. They did say it's going to be, what is the next one? Batman v Superman?
Well, yeah, the one that comes out.
Next year. Then Wonder Woman, Justice League 1.
And then Justice League 2?
Yeah, and then Batman.
And Cyborgs and Aquaman.
Yeah, Cyborgs 2020. That's a while
that far away?
Not 2019. Green Lanterns 2020. But yeah, so I'm intrigued by Batman. It comes out, I think, after the first or second Justice League. I'm not sure exactly.
And they still have a Superman movie on backburner.
Yeah, they said George Miller, who was in talks for the original Justice League years ago, he even dropped out. I don't think they're making. I think it's just going to be the Justice League that he's in. I really do.
But they're going to go straight to this with no Jason Todd background.
Yeah,
it's going to show up,
and they're going to probably do it in flashbacks.
And then they're just going to do, like, the magical mystery Lazarus Pit. He's dead, but he's resurrected.
Yeah, and they said it's kind of clever because, you know, they could use the Lazarus Pit to make Ben Affleck look, you know, younger. Because in the Batman v Superman, he looks very grizzled-like and beat down. They said it's a nice little out, too, that he could fall into the Lazarus Pit and come back a little bit more youthful in the movies.
Magical Pit.
Or why not make him the same age he is?
Well, they said here's the issue. Warner Brothers,
Oh, yeah! See, we got the Batman, but the Batman can't be old! We need young, virile Batman!
And that was the issue. They liked the idea of him being the older Batman, and then they saw the test footage, and they really like it, so they want more films from Ben Affleck.
Yeah.
And so they're like, we don't want him to be 50 years old in the movies, though.
Yeah, we don't want Gray on the Temple! No! So he's got to have 30-year-old boner!
Because that's why they're making this a prequel. And I'm like, that's genius. Good for you. Wow. You might want to think about that before you spent $410 million into Batman v Superman.
I hate it already.
I'm intrigued by it. I'll see it.
Sure.
Kevin from 365 Flicks really likes it. He's really excited about it. He did say Zack Snyder, is a hell of a director.
Sure.
I don't know what he's watching. I saw Sucker Punch. 20 minutes of it. That was enough.
So he's serious when he said that.
Yeah, he was serious.
Because I've never heard anybody compliment Zack Snyder.
Calling you out there, Kev. And quickies. News quickies. We need a little bumper for quickies, too.
Quickies.
Done.
Is that it?
There you go. We just made it. The first Fallout from the movie. Or, I'm sorry, from the video game. Beer. First Fallout beer came out.
Yeah.
Now, beverage-related promotion. Fallout 4 will have this autumn. It's called it was announced on Fallout's official Twitter page that Bethesda has teamed up with Jones Soda.
Jones.
To create and release their own version of Nuka-Cola Quantum?
Nuka-Cola Quantum.
Popular beverage from the Fallout game series to be sold exclusively at Target.
I was excited to hear about that. You know, they're getting Jones Soda to make a thing for it.
Yeah.
I think that's Brilliant idea until I read the next line.
Until you read the next line, exactly.
It'll go on sale November 10th, so next week.
That's not the next line we're talking about.
Sorry. The product is not an original creation, but a repackaging of the berry lemonade soda that Joan sells.
Yes. We're just taking what we already saw, like, make it Nukem Cola.
Yeah, looks good.
And berry lemonade. That's not even cola.
Berry lemonade. Yeah, it's not even,
Will you buy any?
Probably.
Okay.
I will do it for a gag, because I'm a Fallout fan.
I'm intrigued by the Fallout beer. It's just a Miller Lite. They just slap it on. This tastes like Miller, but it has a sticker from Fallout.
No, wait, hold on a second. It's from Steel. It's what's
Steel Reserve?
Pits. No, it's from the Pits. It's Iron City beer.
Oh. Steel Reserve might be worse.
What was Steel Reserve?
Steel Reserve.
Pittsburgh beer, yeah.
Steel Reserve is Pittsburgh, but I don't know.
Piss water.
Sorry, Pittsburgh nerd. Ugh. Oh, and other nerds, Pittsburgh nerd. Bengals won. Anyways. Our quarterback wasn't as bad as yours.
We're not the worst. But then again, Thursday, you ready for the big match?
I'm going to it. Okay. I'll be there. If only I wasn't going to, we could have done a live podcast for the Browns game.
Oh, my God, no.
We got Johnny Manziel.
You know the sad part.
Johnny's playing.
When did Cleveland's owner just become Southern? Go ahead and do that again. We got Johnny Manziel.
That wasn't like Southern. I wasn't trying to.
No, you got
that's just
like
me
a
being
Southern
excited.
Draw like this, and here's a Southern draw.
That's just my like Christmas morning getting ready to open presents. Oh, yay! We got Johnny Manziel.
That's a present nobody wants.
As a Bengal fan, we want them.
You return it on Boxing Day the next day.
You know, the funny part was we were up 20-7 against the Cardinals.
My Cardinals, baby!
And I looked at my buddy Verm. He's like, hey, what's that feeling I feel? I said, it's called impending doom. Because we're winning 20-7. You know we're going to lose.
Jeff came over and was watching the games with us this weekend.
Yes. While you were trying out your new electric smoker.
Yeah, fuck you, Blake. Anyways.
Try my new electric smoker. All right, let's get started. Okay, you ready? Okay, here you go. Plug.
Woo! Anyways, Jeff's like, I'm trying to make a Browns joke. Jeff goes, oh no, your Cardinals are down 27. I was like, they're fine. No problem. What happened? They won 34-20. Yeah, I told you they're fine. No issue.
Pending doom. You know, the best part was one of the sports talking heads said, have you ever seen a team do whatever they could to not let Manziel onto the field?
You know, you could trade for Kaepernick. He got benched for Blaine Gabbert.
Oh, Blaine Gabba Gabba Gabbert.
Yes. Yes. Great. Now every time I see him, I'm going to do that.
Yo, Gabba Gabbert.
And I'm not trying to mock you, but what do you hold on to as a Browns fan this season?
Pain. Hold on to the pain.
Jesus, pain.
I'm living with the pain.
According to TV Line,
it's part of me.
CBN out.
I'm always angry.
That's my secret. I'm always angry. I'm a Browns fan. Anyways.
Yeah, thank God I had the Buckeyes to know what a championship like feels like.
The cookie? Those are pretty good, the Buckeye cookies. But then your starting quarterback for the Buckeyes got a DUI. OVI, sorry.
Of course.
Yeah, I got yelled at. It's an OVI, man, not a DUI.
So does that mean he was like on a moped or something or a bicycle? What does that mean?
I don't know.
I think it means he was like playing the radio or something.
I think the car was stopped.
Was he on one of those little self-propelled...
He couldn't get it started.
He kept blowing into it. I know I'm drunk. Let me just blow into the tube. That's how he started.
What are those goofy little self-propelled skateboard things that Segways? Look like a little mini Segway without all the shit?
I don't know what they call those things.
Now, OVI is when the car's not moving, but you're drunk and you're behind the wheel and obviously something happened. According to TV...
Yeah, the car stopped, so I sat in the seat.
Yeah,
that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
I meant to sleep here.
According to TV Line, CB...
On top of the bush.
Okay, can I finish? Top of the bush.
On this person's front porch.
Glad you clarified.
With my car on the porch.
With my car at the front door.
I understand what the problem is, officer. Your car's through the living room, sir.
Nah.
Somebody else put it there.
I thought this was a drive-thru.
Was this a garage? I don't know.
It's drive-thru now.
What? This is not Taco Bell.
The cat had it coming to him. Let's see. According to TV Line, CBS announced today that Alex Kurtzman, one of the producers of the current Star Trek film franchise, will head the next Star Trek TV series.
Yay.
The show will debut in January of 2017, and following episodes will premiere on CBS All Access for $5.99 a month is the CBS All Access.
Star Trek, The Wonder Years.
And they will host host every episode of the original Star Trek series.
Waiting at the Space VA.
So you have to buy a new channel to watch the new
Star Trek. Yeah, CBS came out about 6 months ago, and it's $5.99 a month, and you can get everything that CBS has ever put out.
Yeah.
So you can watch all your Two and a Half Men now episodes.
Was that CBS?
Yes.
Oh, God.
So I'm excited about that.
I can catch up on Survivor.
Oh, goody. I'm excited that Star Trek is coming back. I'm not a big Star Trek fan, but good for them. I'm not going to
subscribe to CBS.
No one's going to pay $5.99 a month to see that.
Someone will.
Blake, he will. And then finally, sure. Fox has given a pilot production commitment to Greatest American Hero, a remake of the 1981 cult classic.
I'm walking on it.
It's still one of the best.
I never thought I could be so free.
Yeah.
Run away on a wing and a prayer.
Or if that was like Summer Breeze.
Who could it
summer
be?
Summer Breeze. Oh, according to Deadline.
Believe it or not.
It's just Blake.
I just think of George Costanza, his answering machine.
Believe it or not, George isn't at home.
Where could he be?
Just leave a message. No, you know, seriously, I was very excited when I saw this news.
Written and directed by Rick, who did Dope. The movie.
All right, now I'm not excited anymore.
Greatest American Hero follows an ordinary man who one day wakes up with superpowered suit, and he never asked for, and has to deal with the complication it adds to his average life. So,
but that was the best part of Great American Hero. He's given the suit. He had no idea how to use it.
Uses the instruction manual.
No instruction manual, exactly.
So it was kind of like Amy Pasquale when she was in charge of Sony. Here's a script. I don't know what to do with it.
No, it was actually more entertaining.
Oh, good call.
Now, will they have to like change the character's name because someone's going to attempt to assassinate the president with the same name right after it comes out?
What's the name on it?
Well, originally it was Roy Hinckley was the guy's name, and then like a month after the Hinckley tried to assassinate Reagan, so they called him Mr. H.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
I think they might have even changed his last name, but...
That's pretty funny that it's so close. Mm-hmm. Oh, that was the same. Okay, so there's your... Good News of the Geek.
It's time for... Box Office Bombs.
All right, bombs this week.
Bombs galore.
Pretty much most bombs are the same bombs we've had the last week or two. Last Witch Hunter is up to $18 million in 2 weeks. On a $70 million budget.
Not going to make it back.
Nope.
It's even only at $50 million, I think, worldwide total.
It might get it back worldwide.
Yeah.
DVD sales will help it.
Yeah.
Do people still buy DVDs?
I don't think people buy DVDs. VHS is going to really just boom.
Beta. Pan, after 4 weeks in the theater. Is it still in the theater?
Oh. Not much.
has made $32 million on a $150 million budget. Pan. Bob.
You know the best Peter Pan that's out there right now is the Geico commercial Peter Pan. Peter Pan shows up at the class reunion and he's still young. He's like, hey, bother. Everybody's like 60 years old.
I didn't see that.
He's just a little prick. It's awesome.
Yeah, I haven't seen that one.
Oh, yeah. This is a great commercial.
I'll have to keep an eye out for that one.
Yeah.
Our brand is Crisis bombed with $3.4 million in its opening week. It only had a $28 million budget.
Yeah, but keep going.
And an audience grade of C-.
Mostly the audience gives everything a B- or above.
Pretty much it's B+, A- or B+ or higher.
Yeah. C-.
A C- from the audience. Ouch.
Yeah.
That's what you get when you let George Clooney write a role for Sandra Bullock.
That's supposed to be like James Carville.
Look at it, you Ocean's 11 remake.
Danielle Ocean! I'm Danny's sister.
And burnt
Thing on brand is Crysis. I was reading an article. They said the reason that people, one of the reasons is they said it didn't look good, but they said another reason is that audiences just don't care about politics in movies. Like, they were just burned out from everything with the election
season.
Well,
we got real politics going on.
They said they're burned out from that.
People.
And they don't want to go to a movie to see more about politics. So they said it was.
Oh, yeah, but they. That's George right. Clooney and his left-wing liberal ideas thought they needed to get this movie out before the
Election.
Before the election.
Right. Stop it.
Gotta get it out.
We did a top five request from Bob.
Well, there
just
you go.
Bob.
It's called
just Bob.
Idiocracy is so important.
Five. He said top five political movies.
Oh, God.
Political related movies.
There's some good ones.
Like,
don't throw out examples. You'll steal some.
Yeah, I mean, but Bullworth. Bulwark.
Oh yeah, you can put Bulwark.
Wag the dog.
Wag the dog's awesome. I thought that was a good top five.
Oh, though. What is that one? That one with
Dave?
The one with Jamie Kennedy in it.
Stop it. Stop it. Stop it.
Where he played B-Ran.
Yeah, stop it. Beverly Hills, whatever. No. Just shut up.
What's that fictional one? It stars the Secretary of State, Benghazi.
Oh, that's the one coming out in Michael Bay.
Oh shit, that was real. Hold on a second. Oh,
I
my
don't
God.
Think it was it?
You're right. It wasn't.
Okay, moving on.
If you're talking about fictional ones, you can talk about Fahrenheit 9/11.
Moving on. What's next, Jeff?
Burnt.
Moving right along.
Burnt bombed with an audience grade of B and a Rotten Tomatoes score.
B-. Yeah.
Well, there is a minus there. Yeah. You are correct. And a Rotten Tomatoes score of 29%. Did we get
the figure in the top five. Coming
oh,
up.
Made,
I don't want to repeat it. Yeah. Oh,
okay. See, I completely agree. The preview sucked.
For Burnt?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you want to watch a movie about, you know, a chef who goes off and has to change his life, go watch Chef.
Or Simply Irresistible with Freddie Prinze and Sarah Michelle.
No. Sorry. Don't watch any Freddie Prinze movie on purpose.
You know,
sorry.
Typical boss is an asshole. Boss is demanding.
He falls in love.
Falls in love with the employee, ever cook. Caesar Whisper's word, blah, 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 blah.
It's really lovely.
But he only pays her 75% of what
she
worth.
Only, and she doesn't get any credit for the dishes that she helped inspire either.
Top five at the box office, October 30th through November 1st. The Martian, another $11.5 million. It's got a lot of money on its sizable budget.
Four straight weeks, number one.
Ooh, that's kind of be like a record this year.
It's doing pretty well.
I think that there's like people in NASA trying to sit there and go, now how can we roll this Martian into public relations publicity for increasing our budget?
We found water.
They did find water
on
Ooh, Mars.
Look at this elevated spoon. Now here's what looks like a bear.
Sir, that looks like a fishing wire.
It's
what
a
are
bear.
You doing?
It's a bear. Look, it looks like a bear.
Damn it, go back to the face. number two, Goosebumps, $10 million. It's pretty much got its budget back.
Yeah, $58 million.
Jack Black.
Bridge of Spies, another $8 million.
The Tenacious D movie?
They did, and it bombed, thank God.
They did?
Yeah, a long
Tenacious
time
D,
ago.
The Pick of Destiny?
You never saw that?
No.
It was terrible.
It's horrible.
Well, there was one good part on it.
But no, are you sure The Pick of Destiny, that was a movie?
Yeah,
it was a movie.
We previewed it.
Oh, my gosh.
Did you preview it?
Yes.
I can't remember it.
Actually, I skipped it because skipped I hated
that.
Him so
yeah,
much.
Yeah, I got stuck alone previewing that one. I remember.
Well, because I remember the Tenacious D skits, the show that they had on HBO was really funny. I thought
that was
pretty
bad.
Funny. But The Pick of Destiny, I thought that was just a long video.
No, that was an hour and a half movie.
Oh, thank God I missed it then.
Well... It's kind of cool because I think Meatloaf plays Jack Black's father, so that his Bible thumping father. Mm-hmm. So that was
everybody loves Meatloaf, the dish and the singer.
Mm-hmm.
And Dave Grohl plays Satan.
Well, of course.
Cool.
Okay, moving along. Yeah, Bridge of Spies, $8 million, $45 million total on a $40 million budget. Hotel Transylvania 2, another $6 million. So it's going to get a Hotel Transylvania 3 coming out in 2 years.
Electric Boogaloo.
And Burnt, here we go. Number 5 with $5 million in its opening weekend on a $20 million budget.
And they said it would be lucky to hit $10 million total.
There'll be enough housewives to go watch that.
Yeah, but, I don't know.
But Bradley Cooper is so dreamy.
Because Bradley Cooper.
Yeah, my wife was like, I'll watch it because it's Bradley Cooper.
Exactly.
Like, come on.
Hey, the holiday, Thanksgiving's coming up. All the women are going to have to go watch something. You're going to get dragged to it eventually.
Okay.
Upcoming November 6th, we got the Peanuts movie. Mm-hmm. Ooh, I almost said penis movie.
That's the other, that's at the other theater.
And Spectre, James Bond, 23.
I'm excited. I'm really going to see it.
I'll see it.
Fuck yeah. Anyone it's here? Bond. Who's doing the theme song?
Yeah, Del. Oh, no, Sam Smith.
Who?
Sam Smith? Okay.
It's not very good.
Okay, I haven't heard it. Normally, like, by the at least before the week it's out, I've heard the theme song. Deal, the
Sam
theme
Smith song, is with
know. Stay with me. Yeah, exactly. After Duran Duran's View to a Kill,
nothing can touch A View to a Kill.
Adele's was okay.
Adele's was really good. I like Skyfall. Really?
I like her new song, Hello.
Let me see. Do I
No, the best no. one is Aha, the one the Living Daylights.
Oh, my God. No.
Oh, was that Timothy Dalton?
That was Timothy Dalton.
Yeah. Was he dressed as a clown in that one?
I don't remember.
I think he was.
Was he? No, I thought the clown was Roger Moore.
It might have been Roger Moore. Wasn't it? Well, he's always a clown, but yes.
You know, here's a little interesting 007 trivia since I've been getting ready for...
False.
No. Since I've been getting ready for the next Bond movie to come out. You know, there's... The critically and the fan... movie, you know, where they ranked all the movies.
Yeah.
You know, tied for first, which was very surprising. I believe it was it Doctor No?
I've heard Doctor No
was like the number one. But it was tied percentage wise with the Bond that everybody hates.
Moonraker?
No, I'm not talking about it. No, with George Lazenby.
Oh, I hear everyone says
Majesty's Secret Service.
Everyone says that's the best movie. He wasn't the best Bond, but it was the best movie. Yeah.
But because he was the first Bond to replace
Connery,
you know, and you always get that backlash the first time he replaces somebody. So yeah, I'm like, wow, everybody hates George Lazenby, but they love the movie. It's like one of the best ranked Bonds out there.
It's because Diana Rigg was in it.
Diana Rigg, that's right, the old Queen of Thorns.
Exactly.
Isn't it amazing to look at those old Diana Riggs, and then look at her now as Queen of Thorns?
It happens to everybody. Beauty is fleeting.
It's going to happen to me.
Find that hard to believe, Blake.
No, I'm going
to
look like
I thought it already did.
Trying to be nice. 24 films. 24.
Okay, this is number 24.
All the lowest they got is Casino Royale from Rotten Tomatoes, like ranked by critics. The 1967
version. That's not Casino Royale.
That's number 26, actually, because there's two movies that was.
But that was
not...
more of a comedy kind of.
Yeah, that was Woody Allen and David Niven playing funny.
View to Kill is number 25 from 1985, and Octopussy was number 24 ranked. So
Moonraker's the worst by far.
Pierce Brosnan's films were 22 through 20 on the Bond films.
Oh, Goldeneye was good. The
Moonraker
other three
was
crap,
19.
Oh, come on. Goldeneye is so much better than Moonraker.
I saw
Spectre is number 17, 64%.
Yeah. Now I've read some of Ian Fleming's books, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
I was always amazed at sometimes how the plots never went parallel to the books.
Oh, none of them did.
There's elements of them,
but
they're not really. But it's kind of interesting, as the Bond series moved on, it's like Ian Fleming said, yes, you can use the title name, but no, you can't use the plot. Can't use that plot. And it's like, it's interesting. Almost like, it's making me money, but screw you guys.
Yeah, there's a fight. There was a lawsuit for a while with his family in that. Mm-hmm. With the films. Yeah. Skyfall is the number one rated film from the critics. 93% fresh.
Yeah,
everyone likes Skyfall.
Number two, just give you a couple. I'm not going through the whole thing. Number two was Casino Royale from 1995, from 2006.
Okay.
And number three was Goldfinger. Russia with Love. And number five was Dr. No. So that's just film critics.
Yeah.
And those were all 96%
fresh. I didn't know Dr. No was put up that high. I know it was the first, but
Thunderball
was
number six.
Yeah, because I think I hear people say Thunderball was probably Connery's best. Some people say it's even better than Goldfinger, but I know Goldfinger is just well-renowned.
Pushy.
Pushy galore. And it had Honor Blackman as Pushy Galore.
Pushy Galore. That's right.
Okay.
Strong independent woman who was a pilot.
So there's your box office. Let's go to top five, baby.
So that music means that you're stuck in a bad presentation at work and you can't get out of it, or
it's a horrible training video, background music.
Or else our top five.
Or a bad attorney's commercial background music.
I did want to do a quick thing from Bobby H. He's been under the weather, so we want to give him a shout-out. He's one of our listeners. Yes,
get well, Bobby.
Bobby! And he also did a quick thing before we get into this week's top five. He did a top five worst horror sci-fi villains from last week.
Okay.
Number five, Detective Hoffman from the Saw sequels. He took over as a disciple of Jigsaw, but his traps were non-survivable and totally lost his cool and just started killing people. That kind of defeats the purpose. Jack Frost, the snowman, is a slasher killer.
But he's got a good nose.
Number three, the tree slash plants in The Happening. I think everybody
has mentioned. Agree with that.
The Mangler, the clothing press from the movie The Mangler, the Stephen King one.
I did not see or hear this one.
I have seen this. It is horrible.
Oh, possessed. Which was the one where Stephen King, where all the trucks got their own...
Maximum overdrive.
Yeah, that was bad, too.
Oh, my God, yeah.
The Mangler, possessed clothing press that gets some blood in it and at night goes homicidal. Yes, it does. And it's like, it's kind of like Jaws. Just stay out of the water or away from the Mangler. Yeah. Like,
or just... Don't go into the
factory. I quit. I'm not working there anymore. And number one, Silver Shamrock Cult from Halloween 3. Oh, when they make the masks. Plans to get all kids in America have one of the three masks on at the same time and watch the same channel, so they magically turn into snakes and spiders and kill people. Yeah, they had some time frame rules and something about Stonehenge. He wasn't too sure.
That was the one that had nothing to do with Mike Myers.
The idea was the studio wanted to do a Halloween movie every year, but they don't want Michael Myers in it. They wanted to do
Oh, they kind of wanted it to be like Twilight Zone, where it had nothing to do with the ones before it.
That didn't work. Halloween 4 was the return of Michael Myers.
I did see a good movie this past Halloween weekend.
What's that?
Over at my buddy's house. We're like, yeah, that's time. We just did all the candy hanging and handing out for everybody. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, let's watch a movie. I watched VHS for the first time.
VHF? Oh, no, VHS. Okay. UHF, that was the other one. That was a good movie.
It was surprisingly good movie.
I heard the sequel was horrible.
I watched the sequel too, although it was funny because you got the GoPro from a zombie point of view. Because the guy's riding his bike through the forest and these zombies attack him. He gets bit, but he's, got the GoPro on top of his head. So he's a zombie walking through the forest. He comes across a kid's birthday party, and you see everything from the zombie's point of view, which is pretty fucking hilarious.
I like that.
It was funny.
I like that.
But, the VHS 2 wasn't that good, but the VHS was pretty good.
I like VHS.
You know what freaked the shit out of me? It was I like you. Where they get the camera and the eyeglasses and they're trying to go
out. Is that the hotel room?
Trying to get his guy to, hook up with the chick so they can film it.
Yes, yes.
That was freaked the shit out of me.
I liked that movie.
It was good.
I like the anthology movies. Like, they have different little stories. The second one I've never seen, but I just heard it was horrible. Yeah. Horrible.
Did
horrible.
You see VHS?
No, I have not seen VHS.
I would watch VHS. Skip the VHS 2. Now, there's a VHS Viral that's out there, which is like the third. I haven't seen that. Don't see 2, except for the zombie portion. And then you probably YouTube that. But, go to the other
thing. Oh, but speaking of... passing out Halloween candy. This Halloween.
I'm surprised we don't have a Halloween topic on our thing here this week. It just happened a couple days.
Great story though. I was over at a friend's house passing out candy. 9-year-old kid comes by. Oh, my friend asked him, "So what are you dressed as?" He looks at us and goes, "I'm a pimp."
9 years old.
And I'm like, "He is." And then he goes down the street. Well, they come back for seconds as they're coming back up the other side. And we're like, we got to give the pimp seconds.
And my sister's if you don't pay, he's going to slap you.
Yeah. And my sister's there. And she's like...
Got to keep that pimp hand strong.
She's like, "Well, I hear that as they say, pimping ain't easy." He goes, "Yeah, it is." All right.
Obviously, the 9-year-old who doesn't understand what he's dressed up as. Or his parents or older siblings said, "This would be great."
His parents were walking along the street there as they came to the door. So
wonderful parenting.
Yeah. They let him be a pimp.
Good for him. In a way. I weep for our future.
Oh. So did we play top five music?
Yeah, let's play our top five.
Go back. Top five.
What?
Oh, sorry. Did anybody say what our top five is?
No one did.
What is it? Top five worst video games or board games you have played.
Top five worst games.
Let's see. Who would like to go first?
Should I get the party started?
Yes, get the party started.
I'm going to have Blake mad at me here.
Oh, God. Here we go.
Yeah.
What's your number five?
Are you ready? If you say Axis and Allies, I'm going to kick your ass.
Then I won't say it, but that's what it is. I just do not like that game one bit.
Oh, it's not so funny when they mock your top five.
Fighting words, son.
What was it last week when you were mocking all my show? Yeah, fuck you. It's not so funny this week. We should match up one week and just get everything that Blake likes and just start ripping on it.
See, now you probably like Risk, right?
I think Risk is okay.
Because yeah,
that's like kind of funny because that was my number five.
There you go.
Risk is my number five.
Everything I like about Risk is ruined in Axis and Allies.
It's just more advanced and different and technical.
So Jeff can't figure it out.
Exactly. No, it's strictly, okay, you have to follow this rule of this country. I mean, thing about that's good about Risk is you can attack anybody at any time. You know, if I'm USA, I'm not allowed to attack Britain.
Well, no, because they're on nerdly.co. Why would you go attack them? We love
okay,
Britain.
I'm not allowed to attack Russia.
You can't move into Canada.
We're big in Russia.
I can't attack Canada?
No.
What's the point? I mean, in Risk, I can attack Western U.S. from the Eastern
Australia's
U.S.
Australia's off limits, too, man.
Australia, New Zealand, Canada, USA, UK, and Germany. Those are our big countries, so let's leave them alone.
But in that game, you have to attack Germany.
The whole point is to attack Germany. Nope. Not at all. Number five for me is Risk.
I'm really disappointed. I spent an entire summer of my 16th year playing a game
of my
every 16th goddamn game.
Year.
Yes, my 16th year. I played Axis and Allies.
Hello, Shakespeare.
I played that with the Omni Brothers.
Why do you sound like the Monty Python guys? my Risk is because I like the idea, but I get it's such a long game.
You can't fight a land war in Asia.
The problem I have with Risk is I hate like the dice rolling and how that all goes and it takes forever.
Yeah.
I just remember like when I was in college, we had the computers. We at the computer lab my friend worked at, so when we had time to kill, we'd just go and play Risk on the computer, where the computer did all the calculations for you. So you just click and say, I'm attacking from here to here. Boom, it tells you if you were successful or not. You didn't have to, I roll this and you roll that, and then we compare. I mean, that's what I don't like about Risk. So I'm like, hell, this Risk on the computer is great. So,
except for the computer AI, which kept trying to go back and take its one province in Australia back the entire game.
Well, we suck.
You're like,
we were playing
sucks.
AI. We were just playing against each other. You know, two or three or four of us are just hanging out in the computer lab. Where my friend worked at like the least used computer lab on campus, so there was hardly ever anybody in there. So we were always playing.
So when you went to college, was it a computer or was it just an abacus?
It was a computer.
Oh, okay. Just checking.
It was a Macintosh.
Oh, okay. Did it talk to you? Hello, Jeffrey.
No, they didn't have speaking capabilities.
You were the computer. Anyways, Blake, what's your number five? Axis and Allies?
No. My number five is any game Jeff likes. No. Not my number five was, I remember I was in between the dead game zone. You know, I'm still in a dead game zone now. But I went in there and, of course, you know, go to GameStop and you got the two millennials working behind the counter. And I'm like, so, young gentlemen, would you happen to have any good zombie video games for me to play? And this young asshole's little prick recommended Dead Island, and I bought it, and I took it home. I played it 5 minutes. I stopped. I was like, this game sucks.
Really? Because it looked good in the previews.
It looks good in the previews, yes.
Okay.
It was horrible.
Okay. Phantom Menace looks good in the previews.
Everything looks good.
Do you think they gave you that one on purpose because you were saying, hello, young gentleman? And you had a little poppycock hat?
Well, you know what? I shouldn't have gone in there saying, hey, what's up, yo? I want a zombie game. What's up?
They're like, hey, Fresh Prince, go out the door, okay? Here's Dead Island. Get the fuck out.
He's that'll like, be $60. Oh, hey, music, Katy Perry. God, I love her. Her music rocks.
She is so great.
Do you like new Miley or old Miley? You like Disney Miley or X-rated Miley?
Did you ever type in nudity in Google? Don't go to the images. What's your number four?
What about your number five? Oh, you did number five. Yeah, I'm bringing it back around. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I don't like the Grand Theft Auto series.
Okay.
Don't like them all.
Morally or just bored by them?
Both, kind of, actually. I like the open world kind of stuff and the things, you know, but yeah. I just don't like the whole bad stuff that you do.
Beating a hooker up after you have sex with her.
Hooker up.
You get points for being
the bad
guy.
Killing. Yeah, I just don't like being the bad. I just don't like it. I've always been a believer. I'm not a believer in no censorship, but I still believe that if you got kids playing these games, it desensitizes you to the stupidity that we have.
Well, that's also
days.
On the parents.
Well, you have nine-year-old
too.
Pimps running and around
so
on
you
Halloween.
You got nine-year-old pimps running around on Halloween. You know, all that kind of, because you think about it, you do this stuff. I think it desensitizes you and it makes you more of a spectator in things. That's why you got all these people recording shit on cell phones instead of, you know, stepping in and doing the right thing.
Well, I used to like the Grand Theft, the first one, or number three, mm-hmm. sorry. But as I've gotten older, I have no desire to really play them anymore. And it's always fun because, and I'm not against them. It's, you know, hey, if they're out there, that's fine. First off, it's on the parents to fish. Because
you get old or something, you know? Could it be that? I don't know.
Well, the other thing is, too, though, it's funny because, like, the Star Wars games or, you know, any games that you can either go down the light path or the dark path, it's like, you always think you're going to go down the dark path. You're like, but I want to help him. That looks. Why would I let that guy get beaten up? I'm going to go help him. And it's always like, damn it, I'm a good guy at the end.
I'm going to be evil. And you always make the good choices.
Yeah, it's like a thief. I don't kill the bodyguards or the, you know, because I always knock them out.
Yeah,
because I feel bad if I just kill them.
They have a family.
The only people I kill, like in the thief series, are the real asshole bad guys. That's it.
So that, like, the guards are just general contractors.
Yeah, they are. Okay. They don't deserve to be whacked. They're doing their job. They're trying to earn pay to take home to their wife and kids, man. They're trying to pay the bills, man.
They got scurvy or something at that age.
The pay sucks already. Why kill them? Just knock them out.
My number four is a game that I was so excited about when I was a kid. Went to the video store, picked it up, came home, and I go, what the fuck am I playing? Super Mario Brothers 2. Hate it, that game.
I like that game.
I hate that game. I got fucking bird things shooting eggs out of her mouth at me.
I don't understand
why. I hate
why
that game.
I never
hate
got
it.
Into the Mario.
I love
shit.
Mario 3. Hate it, Mario
3
2.
Mario 3 is good. I like Mario 2 for what it is.
Well, you're wrong. You also hated Axis and Allies.
Yeah.
Like, I'm on your side.
You're wrong.
Yeah, you can't rent here.
Yeah, aw.
What's your number four, Jeff?
Jeff.
Super Mario 3.
my number four is the Game of Scruples.
Okay.
It was, I suppose it was in the 80s or 90s or something, where they would pose questions, you know, and what would you do? What would you do? And then they'd give you a little poser or something. And it seemed like an interesting game, and we played it. But last time I played it and refused to play after that, one of the ways they did it was, like, some person would read a question, pick who they want to answer, and they would guess how you would answer it, like yes or no or whatnot. And I remember I got a question, and this was before it was even like a hot button political issue, but something about doctor assisted suicide. You know, if you were a doctor and there was no way that you would ever get caught, and you have a patient who has terminal disease and they're in pain and they want you to supply pills and you won't get caught or get in trouble, would you? And I answered, yes, I would. And everybody, this was at like a family Christmas thing or something we were playing. My, you know, cousins and relatives are saying, no, you wouldn't. No. And I'm like,
fuck you on the day of baby Jesus, man. Yeah. Fuck you.
And no, part of the...
they kicked the table over.
And part of the game is if they thought you were lying or not right, then you take a vote of everyone playing. And so everyone said, no, you wouldn't. I'm like, what the hell? Why wouldn't I? You swore a Hippocratic oath. I'm like, I think I'm helping this person.
So
I'm stopping
Hitler.
Their suffering. I don't think Hitler helped
anyone. He thought he was
anyone.
Helping, you know, Western Poland.
He built roads.
Right. He did
in
build
the Volkswagen.
Roads.
What's your number three, Jeff?
My number three is, well, this is representative of a type of game.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't like the games that scrutinize your scruples.
I don't like the games that tell me that well, I can be voted wrong.
My obligations are to society. Fuck you.
You know who else hated that game? Hitler.
Yeah. No, I'm kidding. Go ahead.
But I put down the Kingdoms of Camelot, but there's a bunch of different games like this.
No idea what those are.
It's a Facebook game.
Okay.
And it's the one where you build up your kingdom.
Oh, yeah.
And you put little buildings and you build
the
walls.
The woman with the giant assets, tracts of land.
Huge tracts of land.
She's like this, you know, commercials.
Well, this was years ago before those commercials. I'm assuming these are similar
probably
to it.
Probably the same things.
But it's like okay, well, you build this, like when you're level one, you know, I want to build a building. It'll take 10 seconds. Your building is built. Well, the longer you go, the more it takes. I want to build this building at level. It will take you a week to build. Okay, so I'm doing nothing for a week. Thanks.
I've seen your social life. Yeah. You're not doing much for a week anyways, Jeff.
But if you pay money, you can speed it up.
Yes, and of course.
Yeah, so that's what I'm throwing out there. And when I did this, I went, you know, I haven't been on that Kingdoms of Camelot. I clicked on it. It's like,
your account's been shut down.
Yeah, your town's been shut down. You need to blah, 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 blah. I'm like,
for $5.
never mind. Jason, what is your... three.
The old Atari game, 2600, everybody will say this is the worst game.
Indiana Jones, Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Oh, that game was bad.
E.T.
E.T.
Yes.
Never played it.
I was a kid. I kept falling down the little ditch. My neck kept extending, like the people you see in the National Geographic magazines. It just kept extending. You go up, nope, come back down. Well, up, nope, come back down. And I played that for hours when I was like 7 years old as a kid on the Atari 6900. I was like, I don't even know what the fuck I'm doing here, but I'm going to keep doing it. So fuck E.T. So everybody knows what E.T. is and how awful it was. Yes, so fuck that movie, that game, and that movie. The movie is horrible.
I wouldn't say horrible.
No,
not
it was.
Good. I would say
it was
not
horrible.
Good.
Horrible.
But when they were holding walkie-talkies in the reissue instead of guns, it was so much better.
Okay. What's your number three, Jeff? Blake?
It's similar to Jeff. I'm still playing it. It sucks. I hate it, but I'm still doing it.
Candy Crush?
No. Clash of Clans.
Would you like to donate $5?
I will not increase my town hall to level 9 until I collect a gazillion fucking gold coins to increase each little blip of wall segment past the crystal thing to the skull-looking things.
Yes.
It's a waste of time. Why? But, you know, it's a great time waster. That's the problem. It's a shitty game. It's the same thing over and 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 over again. And I can't stop, but I just keep playing.
Kind of like that with The Simpsons Tapped Out. I like the game, but I know it's the same thing. You just keep going over and over and over.
Just can't stop. I hate it. It's horrible. It's a bad
game. Can't stop the music.
You know, I've looked at that Age of Empires thing. You know, the other Now brother plays. I'm like, why? It's just fucking Clash of Clans.
But the money's going to somebody different.
Yeah, exactly.
What's your number two?
My number two, it's, it's not technically a video game or a board game, but it is a game. And
life in general?
It's that stupid fucking 4.0 Dungeons & Dragons.
I need you to go on a podcast and just talk about that. Because
how much I hate the old 4.0. Yes. Yeah, how pissed off I am about it still. 10 years later.
Does it still have a walking tree? Does it have a walking tree?
Yes.
Okay, good. Go. My number two is the old Nintendo version. Is the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. And you would go into the sewers. Not the arcade game.
I hated that.
And then you would have these electric things in the sewers.
you don't touch them. The point is not to touch them,
Jason.
I
wasn't good enough. I fucking hated that game.
That's the one where you had to swim through and then you could get shocked and you'd run out of air. And then before you die, you switch and pull the next one in.
A fucking turtle. I'm not running out of air. It's bullshit.
Turtles have to breathe.
Yeah, well, you know what?
They're not amphibians.
Well, in my world, they are. Fuck you. What's your number two, Jeff?
My number two is it's pretty much a type of game. The online first-person shooters.
Oh,
all of them.
I hate them, too.
I mean,
Jeff's really good at the
game. I suck at it, and you can't get better because you spawn and die.
Can't do it.
And spawn and die. That's all the game is spawning and dying.
Can't hate it.
spawning and dying while getting 12-year-olds throwing homophobic slurs
at you. Yeah, that's true. I wouldn't even say they're 12, maybe 9.
About the things they'll do to your mother.
9-year-old pimps playing.
Yes.
Talking about your mom.
It is.
I mean, I suppose I'll put what was the name of that game?
Call of Duty
is my main. I bought the system and the game. You know, you guys are playing. I'm going to join.
Yeah, join our clan.
About 3 times I think I played.
So Jeff, stop throwing the grenade in the corner. You're in the corner, Jeff. Jeff, turn around. Okay, you're dead. Okay, time out, Jeff. Turn around. Okay.
Oh, there was no corner.
Jeff, turn around. We're up on that platform. You just died. Okay, Jeff. Okay, Jeff, you're fine.
Just let me run around and draw their fire. You can at least let me do that.
Okay, Jeff, you're going to be the scapegoat. Just go out there.
Just run out in the middle and draw their fire.
You're the decoy. Serpentine. Talking about your mom's butthole. And, you know.
Serpentine.
It's a runny now. What's your number one?
Oh, it's my number one.
I think I'm going to guess.
Oh, everyone knows what my number one on this
life
would be. The game of life.
Yep. Not the actual game of life, the board game life.
Yeah, the board game life. It's a piece of shit game. There's nothing good about it. Even when I was looking this stuff up, I got to pull out a quote here.
I don't like the gender stereotypes where you have to be a pink peg or a blue peg.
I mean, the fact that they force you to get married. I mean, that's bad enough. But
hey, how come if you go to college, you're fucked? Yeah. Here's just like real life now these days. You go to your loans. Here's your $100,000 debt. Yeah. Well, wait a minute. He didn't go to college, and he's getting $100,000 a year as a sports entertainment promoter guy.
But she's making money as a prostitute. That's not fair. Only 77% of the money that the male prostitute's making, but still.
But what if I want a same-sex marriage? Can I adopt?
He became a podcaster. Oh, he's not making money.
But this is an article by Luke McKinney on cracked.com.
Yes.
And they was talking about, you know, bad games.
My life sucks.
Talking about bad games, and he's like, in the game of life. It's like, now that you're too old to play the insultingly simple Snakes and Ladders, how about the exact same game without snakes or ladders? A straight shot across the board, but if you make it across with the wrong, utterly random numbers, you lose.
No strategy.
Yeah. A one-track game so horrifically boring, they had to put scenery on it. Crappy plastic protrusions
that
do nothing but get in the way and make it cost more.
And you lose the pieces.
It's the board game equivalent of 3D movies.
And that spinner sucks, man. I hate that goddamn spinner. It comes off every single time.
There's an illusion of choice at the start asking, do you want to go to college or do you want to lose? That could use a bit of an upgrade. Yeah. They should ask, do you want to go to college? Then ask, what do you want to study? And if you answer, oh, whatever courses look easiest, then you go $50,000 into debt
and
start four
degree.
Turns after everyone else.
Here's your philosophy degree.
And you don't get a job card.
I was going to say communications.
Dear God, communications. Mm. But I read that and I'm like, that perfectly sums up why that game blows.
Well, I like the game of life.
You're wrong.
Now you can sell houses back. It's great. Anyways, moving on. Battletoads is my number one.
Hey, why did they sell insurance anyways in that game?
Because
your insurance, you never get to use it.
There's one space that you can crash your car, one space where your house burns down for your fire insurance.
It teaches irresponsibility by not buying
insurance. Not buying insurance because you're never going to use
it. That's right.
If you do need to use it.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Because
doesn't matter because when you get to the end, you need the random numbers.
$400,000 bank account that never exists. No wonder our kids aren't prepared for retirement these days.
It teaches you that if you play the lottery enough, you'll win.
Yes. Somebody wins.
Anyways, number one, Battletoads. Quite possibly one of the most annoying and hard games, especially when you had the little things that you're flying on, the little scooter things.
And when you play two-player games, did it make it worse?
Yeah, it was an awful game. I was so excited when it finally, like, it was always out at the rental store, and I finally got it, and I was like, I don't know what the fuck this is. This is the most horrific game I've ever played.
Yeah, kids today couldn't even imagine playing.
No.
You thought the Turtles game was bad.
Battletoads was worse. So, what's your number one, Blake?
My number one.
Are you two? What are you doing?
No, two is 4.0.
Oh, okay.
No, my number one game is anything that I lose.
So that's every game you played against me.
That's correct. My type A personality. I hate your games, by the way. Fuck you. We're not playing those games anymore.
So
move on to the next. Bring the next one out.
Well, so what you're saying is you hate Axis and Allies because you lost to somebody once.
Once.
Well, yeah, but that's a lot.
Jeff's brother, who's been on the show before, Jim, he has a game that he always plays. It's called Jim Wins. He plays until he wins, then he quits.
When I'm in the lead, then the game ends.
I had an honorable mention of Superman on the Nintendo 64.
Yeah, that came up when I was looking. Everyone
I remember
said that
playing that game, renting it, and I rented it twice just to see if I missed something the first time.
I
didn't. You just went through circles. That's all you did. You just flew around in circles, and then you crashed into a building.
I had an honorable mention of the Atari 2600 version of Pac-Man.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
I remember being so excited.
They didn't have the rights. Yeah.
Yeah, well, Atari made the original, and they made, I mean, it was, but, you know, the home console wasn't powerful enough to give you frickin' Pac-Man. Mm-hmm. But what they gave you was crap. Oh, it's like they made a big deal. It came out. Everybody ran out and bought Pac-Man. You're like, what the fuck is this?
Mm-hmm. I was never a big pole position fan. Remember that game?
Yeah, that was fun. I mean,
those are the days where the video game cover box was a hell of a lot more exciting than the actual game graphics.
Yeah, look at this. This game's going to be oh, shit. It's a square. But this guy has a pyramid on it. And this guy looks like an Egyptian pharaoh. There's a square on it. He's a square.
He's a square. He's a square.
If you're lucky, it's a duck.
I had a couple of I can't remember this game's name, but if you remember the old Texas Instruments 99 home computer, I had an RPG. It was a type your own adventure kind of thing, where it starts. It's a pirate. It's some kind of like Pirate's Treasure or whatever. And it starts out, you're walking on a beach, and it's like, ask you, what do you want to do? You have to, like, type your answer in.
Oh, yeah.
And if it resembled anything that, it wasn't multiple choice.
Yeah.
So if it resembled any answer that was pre-written, you moved on to the next stage. And I just remember the stupid parrot asked me about pieces of eight. And no matter what I put in there, I could not advance the storyline. I was like on screen three, and I could never get beyond screen three. And I hated that game.
Another one that's similar to that is Dragon's Lair. I hated that fucking game.
I hated that game, too.
That and Space Ace.
Because the video thing, you're like, okay, I want to jump. Yeah. Now. Oh, wait, no. Video cut. I'm dead. What?
Go diagonal. It won't let me go diagonal.
Exactly.
It's not fucking let me go diagonal. The other one that...
See, you just had to be good at the game.
I was not. No, I was not.
I wasn't either. But,
it was a breakthrough game at the time.
It was at the time.
Live animation graphics.
Yes. The graphics were great.
The game was horrible. You just couldn't move that stick back and forth fast enough.
It was pretty much a laser disc with pre-recorded scenes, and you had to tell it, do I go to chapter A or chapter B?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Chapter A or chapter B. Or you have to actually go to chapter A. If you don't do anything, then you die anyway.
Yeah. We did have a lot of response.
Oh, but what about now, as you're older, looking back on some games? Like Pitfall. I thought that was the game
at the time,
was the shiznizzle.
It was great. Yeah.
But you realize you just keep running left to right on the screen. And it's the same three alligator head thing. You got to jump on every single time. It was horrible now that you think about
River it. River Raid, I still think, is one of the most fun games for the Atari.
I remember River Raid. I actually kind of liked that.
Pitfall 2 was fun. That was a little bit different.
It wasn't fun, though.
I liked it.
I didn't enjoy Pitfall.
Yeah, at the time it was groundbreaking.
Yeah, you actually got to go up and down instead of just left and right.
One of the most disappointing games I played was Circus for the Atari 2600. Remember that?
That was the best. You had two clowns on the on the teeter totter to knock balloons out. Yeah. That was the best game ever, man.
It was great.
Even though they were all squares.
Rambo. Rambo for the Nintendo 64. Or, I'm sorry, not Commodore 64.
Yeah.
Commodore 64. It took place. It was basically the plot of Rambo 2. So you're going into this thing, but the problem was it would take, I'm knocking you, like 10 minutes to load on the screen, and then you would get up there, and like three bullets would kill you, and you're like, game over. Wait, I have a machine gun.
Don't go there next time.
But you would go straight up, and it would force you to go up because it was the screen that would push you.
Then go to the left and up.
I've tried, it doesn't work. But
then go to the right and up.
You know what? Fuck you.
You remember the old Atari football that had the three blobs on the screen?
Oh, yeah.
With the little feet.
then you had real sports football. That was a lot better.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Real sports was awesome. They actually looked like football players.
I also had an honorable mention for an RPG.
What's that?
It was the Rollmaster system. Did you ever play that one, Blake?
No, I don't think so.
That's the one where you had charts for everything. Like, okay, well, I want to haggle. Well, roll on this. Okay, that tells me that now I have to go to this chart. Now roll on that. Now I'll go to this chart. I'm like, I'm just... Make do I one, get it for five gold or six gold? Really? What the fuck?
That pretty much sounds like D&D for me.
Yeah, D&D.
I feel like that's what it looks like.
Well, that's what Rollmaster did. It took the fun out of having encounters.
Rollmaster.
And it was R-O-L-E how it's spelled, but it was R-O-L-L or R-U-L-E because there are so many rules.
Rules of the game, Mr. Bond.
I like Rules of the Game. That's one of my favorite movies.
From the cart. Yeah. Some great ones for Mark Bogner from Tangent Bound Network. There we go. Let's see. He had Monopoly. I hate him now.
A lot of people hate Monopoly.
He said he does like Star Wars Monopoly, though. Yeah. Adrian King. I'm a little worried about this one. He said, they said, Adrian King, Clue is still the best board game. Mr. Green was my dude. As far as the worst board game, this was a depressing game I used to play as a kid.
Oh.
Don't Talk to Strangers.
I saw that on Beer and Board Games. Oh my they God. Played that one
I think
once.
I've actually seen that.
Yeah. I saw them play that on Beer and Board
An
Games.
An educational game. Furianus had Trouble or Sorry usually ended in a fight when I was younger. Yes. Chris Saunders, 365.
Send your peg back to start.
We play that Trouble or Sorry. My son plays that all the time with us.
Which one, Trouble or Sorry?
Both. Oh, he likes Sorry the best.
I actually like Sorry. I don't know why people think it's terrible. I mean, for what it is.
I think the popper dice thing is pretty cool.
Chris Saunders had... Honestly, even though I'm a huge Friday the 13th fan, I always hated playing the old Nintendo game, Friday the 13th. That game was awful. I remember that. Oh, go save the campers. Oh, they're dead. Okay, I'm going to go into this cabin.
I think we did rent that once.
They're dead.
Yeah.
Thought that was
You're
stupid.
Dead.
Chris Richardson? Sorry, Saunders is not from 365. Yeah. Richardson is. Sorry, my bad.
Yeah, see, I
too many Chris's. Too many Chris's.
You're screwing everyone up.
Yeah, well, you know, I can't keep track of all the Irish and the Russians. Hey, Chris, I think, is Irish. I'm going with her Spanish. Hey, he said Star Wars Connect. That was an awful game. That was the number one. Two, Iron Man tie-in. I guess there was a video game for that in 2008. Watch Dogs. That was an awful game on PlayStation. I have that. That is an awful game.
You were
game.
Looking so forward to that, too.
Yes, it was an awful game. The X-Files game from 1999, that was his number four. And Jaws Unleashed. Oh, God. I do remember Jaws Unleashed.
And what was the board game where he had, like, fish stuff out of Jaws' mouth?
Yes, that was on...
It was on a rubber band tensioner or
I
something.
I saw that on Toy Hunter on the Travel Channel. The guy found the game, and it was not good.
We had that growing up. The rubber bands always broke and...
Never worked right.
Yeah. The good news is I was not the only one that was excited for Watch Dogs. Yeah. Adrian King said the hype for Watch Dogs was so real until the game turned out to be boring, formulaic, and racist. And it was. He said, Chris Richardson also said he pre-ordered it for release day after playing for about 30 minutes. He goes, after all that waiting, is that it? Yep, I kind of felt the same way. Imran, can't say it, sorry, apologize. He had Ready, Set, Spaghetti. Was a horrible board game. I don't think I've ever seen that game.
I think I remember selling that when I worked at the toy store, but I don't know how that's played.
Matthew McDonald had Don't Break the Ice.
Yeah, that looked pretty bad. I never played that one either. It looked terrible.
It looked like an interesting concept. You would knock out the little white plastic cubes.
Yeah.
It was Jenga before Jenga.
I still have that game.
It's like a horizontal Jenga.
Yeah. Until you're my son and he's like... Bam, bam, bam. Oh, you just took out four pieces.
You lost. No, he does that. You just hit you up. You lost.
Michael Lee? I think it's Michael Lee from the Danger Entertainment Network.
Lau?
We love Danger Entertainment.
Michael Lowell?
Miguel Liel.
There you go, Miguel Liel. He had Transformers board game from 1984, made before the cartoon.
Oh.
It had nothing to do with anything. You randomly moved from hexagon to hexagon. It's Hellraiser level torture. Also, Lord of the Rings Two Towers board game. It basically walks you through the movie like a tour guide. Oh, so like the movie. Never mind.
Like Axis and Allies walks you through the war.
Devin from Snake Oil. We love those guys. Game of Life. It ruins lives.
You're right. You're right, Devin.
Clint Thiel had Rogue Warrior 2009 video game. One of the worst first-person shooters. Let's see. The Lawnmower Man was another one up there. Oh, that, I forgot about that for Super Nintendo.
They made a video game
of
that, didn't they?
Yes. Yes, they did. And then finally, we get some quick ones from Twitter here. Those were from Facebook. Yeah.
Quick ones from Twitter.
Yes. So it was a popular topic today. Mm-hmm. Bobby H. had Guess Who as number 5.
Oh, really, Bobby?
I like that. The new version, though, you don't do it's not humans. It's animals, cars. They took away all that aspect.
Well, that's because it kind of probably got a little racist.
You think? Number 4 is Friday the 13th Nintendo game.
Yeah.
3, Myst, the PC game.
You didn't like Myst?
I didn't like Myst either.
Oh, I like. I loved any of those puzzle games.
I stared at the same puzzle for 3 hours.
Well, you just got to be smarter than the TV screen.
Mm-hmm. He had... Yes. Anyways, number 1, was also was Monopoly. Number 2? Number 2 was Virtual Boy. All of it. Oh. And that's probably a good one. Randall H. Randall Holt, RJ Holt 666. Not evil, just, you know, sign that way. Number 5, Game of Life. Number 4.
Sucked.
E.T. on the 3, Monopoly. What the hell?
Everyone, I told you, everyone hates Monopoly.
2, Friday the 13th.
Wow.
And number 1, Mousetrap. Great, great one.
Oh, yeah, Mousetrap was terrible. I didn't even think of that one. I still don't know how it was actually played.
Another one where you lose all the pieces and it screws everything up. Or just lose one piece and you're screwed.
But Monopoly, the biggest problem I have to defend Monopoly is I think all these people who hate Monopoly have never actually played Monopoly.
How you're supposed to?
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
They've played some game on a Monopoly board by the rules that a friend taught them or their parents taught them. I don't think anybody's bothered to read the rules of Monopoly because I've never played the game of Monopoly.
Or how to mortgage your property correctly?
I mean, people, I do have to say, when you're playing Monopoly, you don't play the game. You play the people. It's like poker.
Mm-hmm.
You know when to pull hold deals them. And how to, you know when right. to hold them, know when to fold them.
I'll give you Reading Railroad for Park Avenue.
But I really, I wanted Baltic. Doctor Number One had, my list of worst is all the Leisure Suit Larry games. Any order you want is fine, just not realistic enough.
not realistic enough.
It's like a porn, choose your own adventure.
RJ Holt also had an honorable mention. He had Predator on Commodore 64. I remember this.
I think I remember that.
He never figured out how to beat the Predator. Trust me, nobody did.
Well, you can't beat the Predator.
In this, you couldn't. Yeah, I remember that game.
In life, you can't beat the Predator. In the movie, you can't beat the Predator.
So there you go. There's your top 5. Thanks for listening. And bad idea of the week. We're going with number 13. Not ooh. Voting. Just vote. Knowledgeable.
We're
be
recording knowledgeable. This on election day.
Okay. Please know what you're voting for.
And as we're speaking right now, pot might be legal in our state.
Down.
Oh, it did?
Yep.
Well, you've been following it while we were recording?
We keep getting tweets about different things. So, yeah.
Okay. Okay, so pot is not legal in the state.
Man, exactly. It was all monopolized.
If I want my pot, I want my pot free marketed.
Hey, man.
Okay.
I don't want the government to tell me that you pay $50 to grow your 4 plants, but we can come and inspect your house anytime we want.
I'm not growing it, so I don't care.
Yeah, neither am I. Thank goodness.
Hypothetically speaking, yeah. Is what you're saying? I wonder what this greenhouse was down here in the studio for.
So I got all windows.
What's this hydroponic shit?
Temp. It's different, right? Anyways.
We're growing it for clothes.
We're hippies.
It's herbal medicinal.
Anyway, so Roger says goodbye.
Goodbye.
From Walking Dead to Talking Heads, from comic books to TV sets, there's a history of not so bad. There's the history. It's the history of bad.
So bad.
The history of bad.
It's bad.
The history of bad ideas. Podcast.
You are now leading the world of Musings of a Geek Podcast Network. Stay geeky, my friends.